Tokyo Beat!
Alex, did you get a mister yet? Have you got a mister yet? Have you installed everything for a mister?
I'm holding, no.
They're working on the Nintendo 64 core. It's going to happen. There's just a new update now. It's increasing compatibility every week. You can load saves now from the SD card. It's the mister. You get a mister yet?
I think I've tolerated your lifestyle long enough.
And the shank.
Ow!
No, to me. Other way.
I don't know. You're a crazed emulation fan. Who knows what you'll do?
Yeah, true enough. Hey, I'll show you not to insult cycle accuracy. It's Number Whoppers. Welcome to the show, everybody. My name is Ray Barnholt, Windows Shift S enjoyer. That's the screenshot key.
I'm aware.
And with me, as always, he puts the Al in Fight Breaks Out in Italian Parliament, Alex Fraoli.
Yes, we got into a bit of a row in Parliament the other day when someone was talking bad about Rebecca Chambers. Why am I in Italian Parliament? All right. I'm like, it's really the gig economy.
Yeah, all right.
It's the gig economy these days. We all got to be scrounging for work.
Yeah. Seat shares in the Parliament.
That's right.
How you been, Alex?
I am fine. How do you do?
Not too bad. You know, 24 hours ago, we recorded our latest episode of A Game Side About Nothing, Crunk Games Podcast, our new Patreon show. It was rip-roaring. You'll be able to listen to that probably concurrently with this. It will be, once again, another free preview. It's a second prologue. But then we're cutting it off after that. But
That's right. You gotta pony up.
Is longer and, dare I say, better than our first episode. So just say, this is the one. This is the one to listen to.
It was very long. I believe it comes out at almost 2 hours. And for about the whole second hour, I'm like looking at my watch nervously like, this is long. Does Ray know how long we're going?
I warned you, though. That was the whole thing.
It seemed long for a bonus show. But you know what? That's the kind of care that we put into our extras.
Days ago, I warned you. This is probably going to run a bit long.
All right.
Clear your schedule, I said to you.
Episode 3 will be 3 hours and so on.
No, it's not like that.
Oh, damn it.
They will vary in length, I'm sure. And
it's good, though. It's a rip-roarer.
Yes, I just said that. You've co-opted my phrasing. You're a joke thief. I appreciate it. Yeah.
What?
Didn't I just say it was rip-roaring?
Did you? Okay, I guess I absorbed that. I didn't realize you said that. Fine, let me amend that. It's a rural juror.
Okay. Well, we'll check the tape. It's all right. It was rip-roaring.
You're robbing people! You're a thief!
All right.
Yeah.
Check the cool wax.
Final count on the edit that's counting the music, of course, is 1 hour 55.
Nice.
So, yes. Look forward to that. But, yes, here we are back on the main line, No More Whoppers, here to do our little thing that we've been doing for so long. Here we go. Alec, hi, how's it going?
Hi, how do you do?
You like stuff?
Yes. You want to talk about the stuff that we've been doing this month?
I would, yes.
All right.
You may start, yeah.
Okay, thank you, all right. You're passing the shell to me, okay. I updated my business license to reflect my voiceover stuff on the advice of my accountant because, as we know, the bar has done nothing but lose money since I opened.
Okay. We'll put this down in the wiki, folks. This is the update the business license episode.
Yes. Basically what this means is because the bar is in such a deficit, any income that I make until it's out of the deficit is not taxed. So if I just do this, I can start keeping a little more of the money that I make doing voiceover stuff. I thought that's a great idea.
Wow.
That means I have to go down to the legal affairs building near Nagoya Castle to update the business license, which a little bit of a pain in the ass because I had to write it out longhand.
Yeah.
But God. Here's a real pain in the ass is before I went, I'm like, you know what? It's 2023 potentially. Yeah. I'm going to go online. I'm just going to download the form that I need to change my business license.
Yeah.
I find the Nagoya Legal Affairs Bureau website. I cannot find this page anywhere. I'm trying to outfox the fox. I am searching for what I think is correct, which I think was just Kodo Gaisha Mokuteki Henko Shomesh or Moshikomi.
All right, that'll be on the test.
Could to the listener. You gotta write all the kanji down. Could not find it. So I'm like, you know what? Let's just go down to the office. I'm sure they'll have a copy. Easy peasy. I bring all my business stuff with me. I got my seal and my license and all my personal info. And I go down there. And I see that when I go in there, they have racks of papers that are samples on how to fill out the forms. And I find one for the form that I want.
Samples, eh?
Yeah. So I pull out a sample, and it's the thing that I'm looking for. You know, change purpose of your business. Here's how you do it. Here's where you put your business name, and here's where you write your new purpose, et cetera, et cetera.
Word.
Now I'm just like, okay, now I just got to find a blank one. Easy peasy.
The warrant!
No! I go up to the desk, and I ask the woman there, hi. I hold up the thing that I have, the example, and I'm like, do you have a blank version of this form? And she says, no, you have to get it on the website. And I said, well, I couldn't find it on the website. And she says, well, look again, it's on the website. And I say, okay, do you guys have like a computer terminal or a printer here or something that I can use to print it out? She says, nope. I say, can you print one out? Can you print one out for me? She says, nope. So I also want to emphasize this is a 20-minute bike ride one way in the blazing sun, the blazing August sun when I did this.
Yeah, not a dry heat either.
No.
In the land of Nihon.
It's what we call a death soup.
Yeah.
So I very annoyedly bike all the way back home. Now that I
air
have
circulation,
I needed it. I got inside. I pumped that AC.
Yeah.
So I get home. I go to my computer. I pull out the example page that I got from the legal affairs office, and I just look up exactly what the title of that was. And sure enough, it comes up.
All right. So far.
And
so
now, hang on. I also want to I want to point this out. The page that I had, the page that I got, said version 5. This was the version 5 bug fix patch. And I found version 5 on the website, the version 5 example. I click on the PDF, and I see the exact page I'm holding in my hand.
I think
very good.
You may see where this is going.
You know where this is going.
I know precisely where, yes.
Right next to the example, it links to the blank file, and I click on it, and it's version 4. Sure enough. And everything on these websites is just named a string of numbers. And I'm doing, like, I'm replacing numbers in the URL trying to find, like, maybe they uploaded and they just didn't link to it right. And, like, no, it's not there.
Nice. Hacking them.
So I go back to the office. I don't print one out because I'm like, well, what's the point? They won't accept it. It's version 4. I bike all the way back there.
Okay. Yeah,
there is now a new lady at the counter. I guess the first woman was on her lunch break.
Of course.
And I talk to this much nicer woman. And I say, I went on the website and I couldn't find version 5. I have the version 5 example. Like, do you know, I think there's a mistake on the website. She's like, oh yeah, I'll print that out for you right now.
Love it. I love it.
Yeah. Yeah. And she printed out a proper version 5. I don't know where she got it.
All right. Honestly, but, not exactly where I thought this was going, but okay.
No, yeah. I think I just somehow by existing, I had incurred the wrath of the first woman. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
She just was not in any mood to help me. Second woman, very nice. Got it all sorted out. Got it all filed away. Went to pick up the new license days ago. It's all good. Now I am officially licensed to record Taranto.
Yes. And for the listener, what does that mean?
Yeah. Taranto is Japanese for talents or actor, voice actor, whatever.
Triple threat.
That's right.
EGOT.
Yeah. Mm-mm. I don't think so.
Well, that'll be later.
All right. Well, I don't even know what the Japanese equivalents of those awards are.
Yeah, well, neither do
I. Emmy. There's probably an Emmy award because Emmy is a common Japanese girl's name.
Okay, yeah.
Grammy. I don't think they do Grammys.
No. Do they do Grammars?
Grammar. You mean Boompo? There is a Boompo award. They do Kelsey's, yeah. I did earn a Kelsey.
Yeah.
And then Tony. Tony Chopper? Does that count?
Where's the gabagool?
All right. So the next step is, now that the business license has changed, I now have to inform like all of my clients, hey, please pay into my business account instead of my personal account. And this, I think, is going to be a monumental pain in the ass because Japan is undergoing, starting October 1st, Japan is undergoing a huge change to the way that you invoice for consumption tax. This is very fascinating.
Okay.
For the listeners. Long story short, it sucks and is dumb. And some people might not want to deal with me if I'm a company.
I'm listening.
I'll deal with Kelsey all day long. Well, maybe not modern day Kelsey.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Well, that,
but that's it. That was another anxiety quagmire that I was wading through that I'm slowly wading out of.
Yeah. All right.
But oh, wow.
Well, we wish you luck as we do all business changers.
Thank you. I think that's the reason I've been stress eating Katsupon for the past couple of weeks.
Okay. Yeah. Probably one of the more dangerous pawns to be eating.
It's so good though. Komeda makes a big giant one that's really good.
Okay. I had a cheese croquette for dinner today.
That's a decadent.
Yes.
At first, I was only letting myself order them if I had exercised that day. And now it's just like, fuck it. I got to have a katsupon. It's not good.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Well, we wish you luck also to your gut.
Thank you.
Let's see how that goes.
Do you have it? Good.
Anything else to report from Japan?
Well... Due to the new business license thing, I cold emailed a big talent agency in Japan. I said, hey, I can do remote voice work if you need it. And they replied and said, yes, that would be great.
All right. Wow.
And then I emailed back to say, cool.
Look at these Cocoa Pebbles.
They gave me the Cocoa Pebbles account.
Yeah, right.
I said, I'm a company. I hope that's okay. And then no reply.
Okay.
I mean, there was a big span of time between the first few emails as well, so I don't think I have reason to panic yet.
My question is,
what?
Do you really have to notify them? Do you really have to make that clear? Because, you know, at least from the American perspective, of course, you can have an LLC and be a sole proprietor and just, you know, be Alex and write down, you know, my business is Alex Fraioli. I'm just doing this.
Yes.
So I'm just wondering what exactly the distinction is to where you need to let people know.
Well, I started to explain it, but it's boring. It's about the consumption tax because Japan does not work that way.
Okay, so it's about the consumption tax changes.
It is about the consumption, yes.
They're if trying you to are, do crazy crap.
If you're a freelancer or a sole proprietor,
I see.
You don't have to worry about that. Companies will deal with you. It doesn't matter. But if you are a company.
Yeah, which you already were. Critical Hit already was. Yes.
Yes, but it wasn't getting paid.
Yeah.
Starting October 1st, you have to become something called a qualified invoice issuer.
Okay. Couldn't they have waited until October 31st? That's much scarier.
Yes, it is. This affects how much of the consumption tax I think you're allowed to keep. Once you invoice, or if you're allowed to invoice for it at all.
All right.
Basically, companies want to be dealing with people who are qualified invoice issuers. And according to my accountant, I don't need to be one because I would not benefit from it.
There's so many like back and forth.
It's so fucking stupid.
Jesus Christ. Can we just have one path to travel down this?
No, Japan's consumption tax system is very convoluted, and this is just making it worse.
Right.
And it's kind of a hated change across the board.
Sounds like it.
Yeah, it's
sounds like what happened in California with the freelancing tax or whatever.
Oh, what happened with that?
Oh, what was that? There was some measure passed where it was I don't remember all the details. Basically, it was a lot harder to be a freelancer in the state of California. A freelance writer, I think specifically, you had to put out a certain amount of work or make a certain amount. God, I don't remember. It was something
what
like
the
that.
Fuck?
It was basically an insurmountable thing for a lot of people who work freelance because it was just, you know, just not going to happen. It was just a weird bar that they raised. I don't know. Whatever shook out of that. I know it was enacted. I don't know if it's just like not a thing anymore or what. I got another question for you.
Hi, go.
Did they give you a vaccine for the consumption?
No. Doctors estimate I will succumb to it within 6 months.
Oh, okay.
What am I leaving you? I've already given you my PSX. If there's anything else you want, just tell Ruri. She'll send it
it's
all.
It's on
over.
The boat.
It's on the boat.
It's on the ocean somewhere.
I sent it out for a 3-hour tour. Who knows where to cut to Gilligan and Co. playing Twisted Metal Black on a palm tree.
Can I jump back to the California thing just so I sound smart? Because I looked it up.
Okay.
Okay. It was Assembly Bill 5, AB5. That was the big scary name. It required companies that hire independent contractors and freelancers to reclassify them as employees if their jobs met certain conditions. And so, the conditions were not great for most people. It was called the gig worker bill because it was meant to straighten out some shit with like Ubers and DoorDash people, I guess. I don't know.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Cool. I found out from my wife that in Japan, the gig, I don't know if it's the word for the gig economy, but it's the wind. We're in the wind era right now.
I'm okay.
I believe this is the kaze-jidai. The kaze-jidai. No, it's reflective of the gig economy. Basically, I think the previous era was the earth era, because you were like firmly rooted in a company. Now you come and go. You come and go with the wind if you're working a lot of jobs, I guess. is the term.
It's all these Zoomers. Am I right?
It's right? Yeah.
Ahem. Moving on.
Gotta love them.
Well, yeah.
So I'm waiting for a reply from this big agency. And I like every day I keep regretting the fact that I sent an email after I was in saying, by the way, here's a thing you might not like. And the fact that they haven't replied is just making me feel anxious. I'm sure it's fine. I'm sure they'll get back to me with a contract. Because they did ask for a copy of my ID, which I sent them. They said they're going to prepare a contract, and I have to sign it digitally on Adobe something or other. But then I sent my stupid email. I'm overthinking it. I'm overstressing it. I'm sure it's fine.
I'm sure you are. How are you phrasing it to them? Because, could you say, hey, due to these changes that are coming – I have to say this and
I didn't even mention that at all. I just said, hey, if it's possible, can this contract be between you and my company? Although I think the individual talents still have to sign. There is a behavioral guideline thing I have to sign. That's I won't talk about the jobs. I won't. One of the stipulations is I won't appear in porn.
Probably don't do that. Yeah.
Yeah.
At least not until you're completely has been.
Right?
Yeah.
Uximo.
That's that. Yeah, Fuximo. Whoa. That's the new, yeah.
Check out what I saw the Uximo guy in.
Yeah, Fuximo.
I walked into that one. Excuse me. All right.
So that's all the news from my mouth.
All right. Thank you, Alex's mouth.
I don't think there's much else happening in Japan.
Okay. Nothing at all important.
No. Although I have been stressing lately over the fact that we're
more
due
stress?
For a I can't stop stressing, man. I hate it. We're due for a humongous earthquake in the next 30 to 40 years. No, maybe it's 20 to 30 years.
Yeah. I lived on the West Coast my whole life. I've heard that about every year as well. So
yeah.
But yes, yeah.
Cuz I've
talking about the big one.
We Aichi is almost right on top of something called the Nankai Trough, I think it is. And the specifically there is something called the Nankai Trough Megathrust, which is
Alex's is porn.
No, I was going to say it sounds like an RPG attack.
Yeah,
but it's there is a 70-80% chance it will hit in the next 20 to 30 years and will basically destroy Nagoya, I guess. I think they said it would be an 8 or 9 0 quake from pretty close to here.
So pack your bags.
Yeah, it's just because we live in kind of an old building. I mean, we just bought this place. But I don't know. It's a I hate that. That's so they are saying that it is that likely to happen that soon.
I will tell you what, when you have any degree of home ownership on you, you will definitely worry about all those things a lot more, of course.
No, it's less the home ownership and more us dying in a pile of rubble.
Hi, Alex. I am saying that. I am saying it is not the sole foundation of you worrying about it. I'm saying that might be a contributing factor because it's just one of those things anyway. Things pop up all the time. Things seem extra serious. You worry about certain things.
Not like life-threatening events.
Okay. Fucking forget it. Let's move on. Yeah, I understand, though. I understand. But I have, like I said, also, I've heard it a lot. certain earthquakes have happened, at least, you know, where I was. I mean, there was a big one in Seattle around 2001 or so. And that was, you know, breaking some buildings and stuff along that line. Nothing as big or serious since then, I think. Not even in the other states like Oregon or California. So, I mean, it's one of those things where, yeah, the longer it just doesn't happen, the more concern rises up from the public and everything. So, yeah. At least you're not alone in your intense worry.
Yeah.
But being prepared is always the best thing you can do at this juncture, right? It's always just like, have a plan, have your goods, and so on.
Yeah, we got goods, we got water, we got, my Game Boy's charged.
Okay. Got any cream corn on you?
Yes.
All right. Oh, that reminds me, I had corn potage potato snacks from Japan.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Wasn't ready for them.
Oh, really?
That was way too much corn flavor for my weak American tongue. That
that's a lot. Brother.
That was pretty bold, but I, still finished the whole bag, of course. I just had to.
That's a snack that I think I got sick of/on.
Yeah.
Earlier on.
I definitely couldn't have much more than a bag, probably, because then it would just be too much sickness. And, you know, then not again for, let's say, 6 months. Intense.
Intense corn.
Yeah. That is not snack food copy or snack food newsy, so don't worry about it.
Snack food newsy? Christian Bale on the cob. Sorry.
I did have some drink food newsy. But only in my case, because it turned out to be like several months old. I just saw that they now have zero sugar Monster Energy.
Yeah.
So, it's like Coke Zero in the sense that it retains the taste of the original. Because they did have like a low-carb Monster Energy, and it didn't taste like the original. And it was kind of weird.
Yeah, but who's drinking
more
Monster
like
for the taste?
okay. Well, I mean, it has to be not completely offensive to be consumed, right? I mean, people have to accept it on some level. So
I don't know. I quit drinking energy drinks when they started making my eye throb, and I'm not looking back. So
how's that going? By the way,
this conversation holds nothing.
You're checking
for me.
Out your eyes and all that. We had some drama about it, talking about last time.
I stopped drinking energy drinks and I cut down coffee, and the throbbing has improved.
Yeah,
until a couple days ago when I made the mistake of trying to play a video game from the couch.
Oh, so it's still not completely, you know, fixed.
No, it's, I don't know what it was, but trying to play a game from the couch made it bad for like 2 days straight.
Jesus.
And I don't know what the fuck it is, because every doctor I've been to is just like, no, you're fine. Am I though? Cause this fucking hurts. Like, I don't know what else to do or show you or tell you to convey how much this fucking hurts and is affecting my life. But every doctor is just like, there's nothing wrong with you. Are you fucking sure, doc? Not yelling at you.
No, I know.
Or am I? No. Oh. I mean, you are wearing a stethoscope today for some reason. I'm moving.
That's why. Well, now that you've eliminated one possible explanation, the energy drinks being like, technically, you could go to yet another doctor and explain that, hey, this happens specifically when I am playing a game from the couch. Now, is it actually for when you're playing video games and not just watching something from the couch?
It's both, but it's more video games. Because I watched all the way through The Venture Brothers, which I'll get to later.
Uh-huh.
And I watched that from the same distance I was playing the game. And that made my eye hurt after like hours of it. Whereas the game, it was like 30 minutes and my brain is like, you have to stop this immediately.
I'm curious. What is a 3D game or the Sea of Stars?
Because Sea of Stars. Been,
okay,
yeah.
Weird. Weird. Mm-hmm. You know, we'll talk about that later,
it's,
I guess.
It's just, it's the movement. It's when I'm watching something, it's passive. I don't need to focus on things specific, but video game, there's just constant movement and my eyes have to keep darting back and forth and focusing on different things and it hurts.
Okay. Yeah. I see what you're saying.
But according to the man, there ain't nothing wrong.
What if you played older games? I mean, you like Phantasy Star. Why don't you play Phantasy Star again?
Oh, I do. Yeah, maybe I will.
Try Combat on Atari 2600.
Okay.
It rocks.
Is that your review?
Yeah.
Okay.
Have you played Atari today?
No. I'm not really an Ataro. You know?
The guy from Urusei Yatsura? Yeah.
Exactly. I said this much in my YouTube video, like I can't play anything before the NES or the Master System. It's nothing to me.
It looks like nothing to me. Yeah.
Yeah. Everything
That's
tastes like pee to me.
Reference.
Is it?
Everything tastes like pee to me.
No, not that.
Oh.
Yeah. Well, I this week is coming off of last week where my wife had an impromptu trip back to Vietnam.
Fun.
Much like you and your business license, she had to go and update her ID.
Oh boy.
So that long story short, so you know, in case her parents, we don't have parents anymore, their land that they have can go to her, essentially, you know, and there's no confusion that because she has a proper ID, legalities, all that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
So she went the whole week, Saturday to Sunday, and I was not actually alone but fairly alone in taking care of our baby, and that was kind of cool, nice and fun, really. I mean, he does still go to daycare, so it's not like I had to take care of him 24/7. But, yeah, we made it through. It was a bit tiring because I did, of course, have to wake up when he wakes up, which could be anywhere from 6 a.m. to 7 a.m.
Oh, boy.
And that was literally every day. I'm not someone who wakes up at that time every single day. I like to, you know, like most people, I think, who don't have kids, like to sleep in on the weekend, Saturday, Sunday, maybe for a little bit, for at least a couple hours now. But I did make it through. I made it through better than I thought, to be honest, for someone who tends to be very tired in the morning, not a morning person generally. I did pretty okay.
I, too, am not a morning person.
Yeah.
And I I'm trying to explain to my wife that anything you say to me for the first hour I'm awake is not going to stick. Like, you're going to have to repeat that later.
Well, I'm not sure I'm that bad, but yeah, I understand.
I am that bad. I'm in straight up mummy mode for the first hour.
You're just nothing, huh?
I'm just, yeah, just not there.
Wow.
I'm physically moving, but like my brain has not woken up yet.
All right.
We've had a lot of interactions that are like, you know, hey, did you take that thing out of the freezer to defrost for dinner like I told you? Like, you didn't tell me that. Yeah, I did this morning. You can't tell me things in the morning. Yeah, they're not going to stick.
I see. Yeah. All right.
It just doesn't get through.
Oh, boy.
Did I tell you I'm Italian? Let me restate that.
See, I've got sleep brain.
Yeah. Yep. Too bad.
Alex is here. Alex, give me your last name. Pronounce it for me.
It's Jimmy. What's your favorite Sega console?
32X.
All right.
God damn.
Pretty good. Never not chaotic.
The funny thing about my wife's trip is that she landed next day, went and got the ID stuff done, then clean slate. So she just enjoyed herself back home for a while. So that was nice.
Cool.
She brought me back some Uniqlo shirts.
Nice.
Not exactly unique to Vietnam, but cheaper thanks to the exchange rate.
Very nice.
One of them she got was a ukiyo-e shirt. Again, not very Vietnamese. Pretty much the only Vietnamese things about these shirts, I think, was where they were made, Vietnam.
Oh.
But and the second shirt was something I didn't even know they had and wasn't really going to run out and buy, but it was one of the shirts from their Super Mario Brothers movie line. And it is Uniqlo shirts these days. They're special graphic tees and stuff that they do with the collabs and stuff. Their designs are just pretty crappy these days. They are just so basic and so milquetoast compared to what they used to be even a few years ago. It's just so funny. And I'm going to try and find this picture of the shirt. It's so silly.
What is it?
It's just a very, very plain looking shirt with a tiny picture and tiny text. I'm trying to find it for you.
Okay. I hope that eventually we can describe this to the audience.
I want you to describe it because I want the fun of Alex seeing
it. I can't even zoom in on it. It looks like it's an extremely tiny rectangle with Mario and Luigi and text that is too small to read.
It says the Super Mario Brothers movie, Brooklyn.
Great. It's
just, yeah, it's a cropped rectangular version of like the promo art that they had for the movie. It's
Oh my God. It's so tiny. And it doesn't help that the image is tiny, like up just near the collar. I see the logo and some small text, but from afar, it just looks like it says UTI. That's not a good brand for a t-shirt. Okay.
Anyway, it's on deep discount now at Uniqlo. They put it on deep clearance. I can't imagine why. But yeah.
I do like the pipe on the left sleeve, though. That is cute.
Oh, yes. They like to do that stuff, of course.
Yeah.
Of course, I appreciate the gift. I just think that Uniqlo's approach to it was funny. So, yeah.
Uniqlo's shirts are – they're not hit and miss. They're mostly miss, but when they hit, they're really good.
Yeah. I mean, the ukulele shirt is cool. It's not just a tiny graphic in the center. It is the full shirt, basically. So – they have their licensed collaboration shirts, and then they have their more artsy shirts. And the artsy ones are still pretty artsy and, you know, fashionable enough, like eye-catching, I guess. But the collaboration shirts are just – they're on a downward spiral, I would say.
I was very disappointed by their Final Fantasy line for the 35th anniversary.
Yeah, last year, dumb.
I guess. Yeah, like there, I think there were two or three that I liked, and the rest of them were just like, here's the logo, you nerds. Okay.
I would say the same thing, but I'm still like, I'm still not going to buy these. I don't like them enough to buy them.
I bought one. I bought FF12 because FF12 was the only one I thought that was cool. It was just a like light brown, like a khaki colored t-shirt with the five judges.
Yeah,
in
that's
the
true.
Middle.
That one...
And that's it. Like no text, nothing else. Just there you go. Just an image, an iconic image.
That probably was the best one of that. Yeah.
And the best shirt I ever bought there was, this was maybe 2009, 2010.
It said, kiss me, I'm Italian.
No, it said, rock me, Amadeus. No, it said,
rock me, Amadeus.
No, it didn't say anything. It was a Tekken shirt. It was just a navy V-neck t-shirt with white silhouettes of like every Tekken character up to that point. And it was great. Again, no text, just silhouettes, like characters that you obviously know from silhouette, like Yoshimitsu, Kuma, Heihachi. And I finally retired it a couple of months ago because it had started to develop a tear.
Yeah.
And then I got shat on by a pigeon.
Okay.
On the way to work.
Not a Tekken fan.
No. That pigeon was – it kept talking about Virtua Fighter.
This is for Tekken 4, you jerk.
So it was on my way to work. So I got to work and I just threw it in the garbage. I'm like, fuck this.
Okay.
And I called my wife and said, please bring me a shirt.
All right. Works in a pinch.
Yes.
Okay. Not bad. Well, I'm sorry you lost a shirt that you liked there.
It's fine. It's okay to throw things away. Like my wife, unfortunately, is a clothing pack rat. And I do not know how to get her to not be that. It's getting to be a problem. I was a clothing pack rat, and now I'm in a place where I'm like, no, throw it away. If I haven't worn this in a year, like, it's going. It's gone. Goodbye.
Wow, a year. That's pretty good. That's a tight window. But hey, if it works for you,
it is.
Okay, sure.
Well, I mean, because I have all these clothes, and I keep saying, I'll wear it. But I never do.
Yeah.
I never do.
Okay.
I cosplayed several times.
I did. That's where you wear special clothes.
Yeah.
To be a character.
Have you kept those?
No.
Okay. You still have a giant wrapped cross in the closet.
Honey, where's the cross?
like Samuel L. Jackson in the Incredibles. Where is my super suit? Where is my White Wolfwood suit? I need it for the ball.
I'm in a real crucifix.
Right. Try again, Stampede. That. Now streaming.
Is that the name of the show? Because that's the thing. That's your last resort, is try gun.
I think so, yeah.
Okay. All right.
Having never seen it, you know, I just assumed at first glance ever, it's like, oh, that guy's name is Trigun. No, it's an even stupider name. I'm like, oh, okay, well,
yeah,
fine.
No, I did watch the whole original series in high school. I think it's just called Trigun because he has a third gun somewhere. Because he has two guns. He has two guns. He has two guns, and then it's revealed that there's a third gun.
All right.
I think that's as deep as it gets.
Okie dokie.
Yeah, it's pretty dumb.
For the most part, all the character names are very good, very Guilty Gear caliber names. So yeah, I can respect it. It's just like, wasn't ready for it. So yeah, it was me and my mom taking care of the baby last week. It all worked out pretty well. Not a whole lot of fun trying to plan meals around him. I mean, we have been doing that regardless, but just the fact that, I had to basically start it all up again by myself. Not easy, not fun, but you do it. Because you have to, because you're a dad. And not much more to say. It was an all right time.
You're doing it, though. You're putting in the dad hours.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
He's doing okay. Standing a lot more. Likes to stand. Holding himself up on the coffee table or whatever he can get to stand up. So walking is imminent. And then who knows what fun we'll have. And also getting a new car seat tomorrow, because he is getting pretty long and he needs a new car seat to accommodate that longness.
Dad, I'm huge.
Yeah, well, he was a big baby, still kind of a big baby.
Hey, this is no time for name calling.
He is a big baby also, sometimes behavior wise just okay. Does not like it if you close a door on him that, you know, a door he should not be going through, will immediately cry his head off.
Imagining him in the final scene of Godfather 2 where they close the door.
He has
to the office.
Toy game controller and a real game controller that he can play with. He would rather play with the ones that we have because mom and dad are using it. Sort of typical cute things, but not so cute when he is becoming inconsolable over it. So.
Aw. What kind of games do you like to play? Is he playing like a low G man?
No.
No?
Not so much even playing, just flicking the analog sticks. He likes to push the analog sticks.
So he's ready for Mario Party.
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Cool.
Just strap his palm to it and watch him build up that callus early. But he's
good stuff.
He's great, doing great.
Good. You found a job yet?
No.
Okay.
I'm afraid not.
All right. Well, it is the wind era. Just so you know.
okay. Sure. We'll get him in and get him driving the Uber.
All right. Mini Uber. Uber's for kids. That's a brilliant idea.
Great. Get that funded.
Uber Junior.
Check out all the venture capital there.
Right. Speaking of venture, I watched the entirety of the Venture Brothers
for the past couple weeks.
No, I'd seen seasons 1 and 2 as they aired.
Okay. So you just need a refresher and then get on to the new stuff.
Yeah, I watched select episodes from seasons 1 and 2 and then just from 3
seasons 1, 2, and 4.
Yes. I completely forgot that the show is so old that seasons 1 and 2 were not in widescreen.
Wow, that's old.
For a series that just had a movie come out last month, like struck me as weird. And I was very confused at first because what they like to do in a lot of episodes is in the first 2 seasons, and I guess in every season, the first scene will be in widescreen.
All right.
So when we were watching Adult Swim in the early 2000s, we were watching on a 3x4 TV. We were watching 16x9 letterboxed intro scenes. What that means when you watch a 16x9 letterbox scene that's in a 3x4 video file is when you see it on a widescreen TV, it's just in a gigantic black frame.
Right. That's how it goes. Yeah.
So when I fired up these episodes, I was very confused. I was scrambling to go through my TV settings, like, what's wrong? What's happening? Why is it doing this? How do I get it to zoom in on the actual action that's happening?
Yeah.
And then after the intro happened and it turned into 3x4, I was like, oh, right. Okay.
Okay.
There we go.
I see. It freaked you out a little bit. Yeah.
It did. Yeah. But yeah, just incredible top to bottom. One of the few shows that just gets better and better as it goes along. And then the movie was kind of a great capper to the whole thing. A lot of fun. Big recommend.
Now, does it stay consistently funny? Is that why you're into it?
Yes.
Okay.
I mean, that's part of the reason why there were years between seasons.
I know it sounds like a weird question. I'll get to why, but yeah, go ahead and finish explaining.
I think that, like, the writing even gets better because a lot of the humor in the first couple of seasons is kind of like played out nerd humor in 2023, but in 2004 it was new and fresh. But it has since been adopted by a lot of nerds on the internet. So then I feel like after that, from seasons 3 onward, it steadily got, like, the writing just kept getting better because I think it knew it had to be more original, and it just kept getting more original.
All right. Yeah.
It was relying less and less on the tropes that it was making fun of and started actually writing funny characters, you know, that are, I mean, a lot of the characters
in
are
an
parodies.
Original fashion.
Yes, a lot of the characters are parodies of existing characters, but many of them are also, you know, they have very original stories written for them. Okay. And I really enjoyed it. Don't know why the entire series was $10 on iTunes. I snatched that up after I bought the DVDs. My DVDs shipped, and then I saw it was $10 on iTunes, and I was like, well, guess I'm getting both.
Yeah. Hey, don't look a horse in the mouth.
Yeah, now I have I have it all on iTunes, and I also have the sealed DVD box just sitting under my TV.
All right.
And the movie, which I got on Blu-ray, which came with a poster. Mine was misprinted and cannot be properly unfolded, so it's staying inside the box.
Okay.
It's fine. I don't need posters anymore. This is not – despite the fact that I started watching the show in my dorm room. I no longer live in a dorm room that I need to put posters in, so I'm good.
You can hear more about Alex and his dorm room on our Patreon bonus show.
That's right.
Game Side About Nothing.
Yes. Actually, wait. By 2004, I was probably living in my first apartment.
Oh, right? God damn it. My earbud tip tore. I got a tear in my other earbud. This is
that a
travesty?
Sounds like a child's playground rhyme.
All right. Don't turn that into something else.
It's a real tongue twister.
Damn it. Okay. This is terrible. All right. I asked you if the Venture Brothers kind of stayed funny because I never really watched it consistently or anything. I think probably just saw the pilot or whatever. And I got confused. Like, I admit it. I got a little bit confused about people who were just speaking about it, fans of the show, longtime fans of the show, who kind of speak about it in such in such reverence that it seemed like there was – I don't know, like more dramatic elements that people were following more than the comedy parts. And
yes.
It is on me, and I know there, you know, I did come to learn that, there is plots. There are stories to this program, but it seemed like people were concentrating more on that. And some of that is my ignorance. I think people would watch a cartoon show and a humorous cartoon show and be more appreciative of the comedy, but I don't know. It just seemed like people weren't focusing on that, and I don't know. But just to hear it from you is fine, and I get it. It's a balance of things, comedy and drama. That's the perfect theater. So yes, I guess I don't really have a point. It was a weird feeling I had about the show in particular.
There is an ongoing lore to the show, and that's why the movie was so good, is because it ties up most of that lore. And
okay,
like let's kind of frame this properly. Mm-hmm. It's a show that started that is a parody of, first and foremost, Johnny Quest, but also a lot of comic book stuff, a lot of G.I. Joe stuff, a lot, any facet of nerd culture from the 70s, 80s, and 90s is parodied in the Venture Brothers. And it started out like that in a pre-MCU world. And then as the series went on and the MCU became a huge thing, I think the interconnectedness of the lore started to take more shape.
Right.
I guess so that by the very end, it feels like, oh, this was a very satisfying conclusion that I don't want to say was influenced by trends, but like, I'm glad that they said that their process for it was like, they didn't plan it all from the start, but like when they wanted to connect plot things, they would rewatch old episodes and write down small details and then work them into future lore.
No, that sounds nice.
So it's a lot
neat. I like that.
Yeah. The continuity is really good, but it's not all, they didn't, it's TV. You can't plan to do 12 seasons to be like, all right, so this is how season 7 works and then season 8. What?
It's not TV. It's HBO.
I'm sorry. It's not HBO. It's DiGiorno. Stop eating my television.
Sorry.
Yeah, it did start out as just like a comedy parody thing. But then as the seasons went on, there was so much lore happening that they interconnected it into a satisfying overall plot.
All right.
By the end, it really felt to me like what Rick and Morty, I think, is trying to be or thinks it is.
Okay, sure.
It's like, it's doing – Venture Brothers actually did the dirty work of writing emotional scenes and having sympathetic characters instead of just, I'm bad science man. I hate my family, I guess. No, wait, I love them. But I hate them, though.
Right. Oh, and we also have to figure out multidimensional type pseudoscience and make sense of that. Blah. Yeah. No, yeah. I like how you put that. Yeah.
Yeah. It's I don't know, I guess Rick and Morty for grownups, I guess is the term, the way I would put it. It's just a very satisfying. And I think I was talking to Maddie about this, but she said it's like one of the only shows where pretty much all the characters actually grow and change and have satisfying arcs. Okay. Cause you don't really see that a lot because it's easy and lucrative to keep your characters stuck the same because that's what the audience knows.
Yeah.
Why bother changing them? But it turns out like as a piece of art, it's much more impactful and worthwhile to see them actually grow and change.
Hey, just a side question. What season is The Simpsons on?
I want to say 58.
All right.
Yeah. Homer's still dumb. Yeah. Yeah. A lot of good stuff. Big recommend. If it's still $10 on iTunes, I recommend everybody pick it up. If you're going to do a watch through, please be aware there are two specials that you need to watch in the order they're meant to be seen in. And when I bought them on iTunes, they weren't inserted. They're just separate things. I didn't know I was supposed to watch one at the end of season 5 and the other at the end of season 6. So I watched them after watching all 7 seasons and was like, oh, well, this was information I really needed for season 6 and 7.
All right. Would you mind, for my benefit, giving me like a gist, you can avoid spoilers as much as you want, what kind of information that's giving you, those specials?
There's a big event that's referenced all throughout, I believe, season 7.
Okay.
It's actually the cause of a character's death. And when that character died at the beginning of, or no, maybe season 6, at the beginning of that season, I was like, well, that was abrupt. Well, I'm not going to question it.
Oh, something predicated in the special.
Yeah. Because it's like an hour-long special. It's a special. It's a big plot thing. There's a lot of plot stuff that happens.
I understand, yes.
Yeah.
It's a really, really special special.
Yes!
Okay. Any other cartoons you watch?
I have not been watching much else. I'm not a watcher. I'm not an Uatu.
Okay.
But Venture Brothers was one of those shows I remember liking in college. So when I saw that the whole series was more or less finished, I was like, now's the time. Let's jump back in. And I had a great time. Super fun time. If it's still $10, I recommend everyone pick it up. The specials are extra. I think all told, it's like 20-something bucks, but still, that's dozens of hours of entertainment.
Dozens of hours of entertainment. You can't put it any better than that. Alex Frioli from No More Whoppers approves.
Very good.
All right. Shall we take a break?
Let's take a break.
All right. We'll be back right after something related to this show.
Keep only three men are willing.
Well, dude, what are you doing, James?
You told me to do the promo for the podcast, right? That's what we're doing. Yeah,
but I mean, you know, we could actually tell people about what we are. I mean, we're the Famicast. We're a bi-weekly show. We talk about Nintendo and games in Japan. I'm Danny, and that was James. And we got another guy. What? Who are you again?
I'm the saboteur. I'm the henchman. I'm the interloper.
That's Ty. He is our anime trash expert. Digs around in some UFO catchers for us. Check us out.
We're in Japan. We like Nintendo most of the time.
The Famicast, only on the Tokyo Beat Network.
I am Ray. That is Alex.
I'm still here.
I'm also still here, and I'm still in school. Of course, we talked last episode about me beginning the fall semester, hopefully my last semester of school. And it did begin, and I am in it, and it is it's going okay. It's all right.
Straight A's.
No.
That means you can pick out any Nintendo game that you want.
Thanks.
I see you holding Iron Sword, Wizards and Warriors 2 over there. Now I'm your friend Alex from the future, and I'm gonna advise you to put that back on the shelf.
All right, what
and
should
pick
I get?
Another game? Do they have Iron Tank?
Another I recommend Iron game.
Tank. Arguably SNK's greatest game.
Oh. Fine, let's right, go with going. That. Where the hell was I?
School.
School's okay so far. The only thing that really sucks is the fall parking. I was not prepared for this. Because last fall at school, I stayed home and took online classes so I could focus on taking care of the baby with everybody. And then I've been going to school during the spring semesters mostly. And my plan is usually just go to this one garage on the roof, and I can pretty much find a parking spot fairly easily. This plan has been obliterated in the fall so far. Now, granted, the fall is where we get a lot of new students, of course. It is the fall. School is starting up for a lot of people. New, exciting opportunities for the new students at school, and they will eventually drop off, a lot of them.
Yeah, they're going to wash right out.
I'm still surprised at the consistency at which I have not been able to find a parking spot within 5 minutes. And in some cases, I am not finding a parking spot within the 90-minute window I give myself to find one.
So, oh, dear.
Twice now, I have spent 86 of those 90 minutes driving around the same parking lot, waiting for a spot to open up. And then I'm late for my first class. Nothing much else to say about that. I'm mostly just surprised. I can handle it. I don't have anything bad happen to me. Plenty of podcasts to entertain myself with. A car that runs. Not much to complain about. Just very surprised at my what I thought was a bulletproof plan is not so bulletproof.
Can you park at a CVS, go in, and only buy one condom or something, and then go out to your class?
No.
Okay.
There's like a 7-Eleven, but all right. I'm not leaving my car at a 7-Eleven.
Why not?
Not in downtown San Jose.
Okay.
Not in a million years. I might as well just be asking for my car to be stolen.
Every once in a while, I have to go over past Freebell, where I used to live.
Okay.
And I know I can park my bike inside Freebell because when I lived there, there were no parking tags. Nobody ever checked. It was just a free-for-all.
Oh, yeah.
So if I'm in that part of the yes. So if I'm in that area of the city, I know there's free parking.
Pretty good. Yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, the school is very silly in the fact that I need a permit for the main garages. They have another garage down by their stadium, their sports field.
Oh.
And you can then take a shuttle up to the campus if you want, except you also need a separate permit if you're parking there consistently. So Not cheap, these permits either. So that's kind of stupid. Doesn't really encourage me to want to do that. But like I said, it's okay. I'll be fine. And I gotta say, the teachers aren't so bad this semester either. Three classes, three teachers. The first one is a little bit milquetoast, but it's mostly a lecture anyway. You don't have a lot of activity there to begin with, so he's all right. He's nice. And then second one, actually surprisingly pretty good, a nice vibrant sort. It's been a while since I've seen a vibrant teacher here at this school. Guy who brings in a lot to talk about, stays pretty on point most of the time, and seems like he actually cares. How about that?
Wow.
And then the third one, just a little bit of an awkward guy. First time, though, I've had a professor who has written a book, but this is not like your big-time Harvard professor who has written, you know, really important tomes or anything. This is a guy, I think, who mostly has done self-published things and on the topic that he's teaching about, which is fine, but his teaching style is a little bit awkward. And his assignments are a little bit vague, and it is also starting at 6 p.m. on Thursday, going to 8:45 p.m. on Thursday, so I have to block out time. I basically have to eat dinner very fast and then go drive to school to sit in class. But again, only one day a week, and I'll get through that.
I had a teacher who wrote a book. The book was all right. I think it was my sociology professor, my second year of school.
Yeah.
When I briefly entertained the idea of being a sociology major. But okay. I don't know what you do with that. I mean, I don't know what you do with a creative writing major either. What?
The study of socios? I don't know. I don't get it.
It's the study of like human interaction more or less and why how we see ourselves and why we do the things we do. And
okay. Do you have any insight on why you yell at me so much?
No! No, what the fuck? No, this is no. That's just a personality flaw that we're still working on. I do get angry a lot.
Anything?
It's the kind of class where you watch, what?
Anything on that?
No! I do get angry a lot. Ray! You know, maybe it's constant interruption. Maybe that's what sets me off.
You know, it might be. Now that I'm thinking back, maybe I'm to blame for some of this as well.
Sociology is the kind of class where you watch Fight Club and The Matrix, and then your assignment is just makes you think, huh?
Yeah, God.
It's pretty much Sociology 101.
That's the early 2000s.
Well, I mean, yeah, but I mean, those movies, like, they are relevant to sociology, to, like, ideas of how we present and see ourselves and others.
I know, but the timing especially.
The timing, very good. Hey everyone, I love FF6! We did not play FF6 in the class, though I wish we would have. Can I explain FF6? It's great.
Can you explain your love for FF6? It's like I was impersonating the drop for a second. Can you explain your love for FF6 in less than a minute?
Yeah. Yeah, easily. I was 11 when I played it, and it was the best looking RPG I'd ever seen. I liked the characters and the battles and the music and everything.
All right. I'll buy that.
I've been thinking more and more that, like, all of the video games that we consider to be classics, so much of that is just down to the fact that, dude, you were 14 when you played it. That's why you love it so much.
Oh, of course.
Yeah. And I'm just getting more and more irritated at quote-unquote game criticism. Like, it's whatever. It's video games are video games, and you're not going to like anything as much as you liked the game you liked when you were 12.
Yeah.
So it's just move on. It's move on and accept that.
I guess slightly related to that, I started playing Starfield because it came it came out yesterday.
Wait, tell me the joke you said yesterday about Starfield before we recorded.
I just... What if Starfield liked Mondays? All right, there you go.
Oh, man. I was thinking about that long after we stopped recording, too. I was, like, just chuckling to myself walking through the house. I don't know.
You're welcome. You're welcome.
Oh, just good stuff.
But I got, like, 90 minutes into that game, and I was like, yeah, I can see why reviewers were giving this a 7.
Yeah.
Like, I can see why this is not hitting it. This is not nearly as advanced as they said it would. It is a Bethesda RPG. They pulled that part off, but they didn't really do much else beyond that. And, I mostly don't mind that. For one thing, I got the game at a discount. I had some Xbox bucks in credit from my Xbox. Microsoft Rewards account. And so I took a chunk off the price there, so that's fine. And I have liked those games before. I've enjoyed the Elder Scrolls games and a couple of the Fallout games. And so, you know, this is mostly fine. It's just like, yeah, some of this seems like, I hate to use the word rushed because it sounds like I'm also saying lazy, and it's not that, but it's just like, yeah, some of this is not as fully fleshed out, I think, as even they would have liked it to be. And,
right, you're into flesh.
That's right. A puzzle of flesh. But it's all right. I think, you know, it's their new franchise. You know, they made this whole original setting and everything. It's, you know, it's spacefarers and things of that nature instead of just medieval fantasy or post-apocalyptic type fantasy. And that's fine. I also like that concept. But it's like, I can see why they didn't go full on trying to reinvent their wheel when they could do that with the next Elder Scrolls game, which they're apparently making. And that is like the game that made that developer, that company. And so it would make more sense for them to try more paradigm shifts with that next game than they would with this one. It's just a new setting.
SNK Trymore.
New setting, but the same sort of gameplay. And, you know, some outlets were giving it sevens and not the eight, not even the nines or tens the stupid idiots on the internet thought it would be getting. And it's not really going to be, I think, a game of the year sort of contender. Not when there was also a giant RPG that everyone loved that just came out before that, Baldur's Gate 3, and everyone seems to be invested in that more than this one. Mostly I was trying to get to your point with, yeah, it's all just kind of dumb. And if anybody thinks this game is a classic, that's fine, but it's mostly going to be the 14-year-olds of today.
Yeah, I mean, that's okay if you're a 14-year-old,
yeah, of course,
and you think a game is a classic. I think I'm accepting that I'm at an age where there will be no more classics. There are no possible video game is going to affect me as much as the games I played when I was a kid.
Yeah.
There are no more tens. There are no more A pluses. It's not a thing that can exist in my brain anymore.
But
you know,
it's just playing video games.
I do,
and that's like good enough.
Yeah, it's fine. But you know, video games don't. You know, when you're a kid, they change your life like multiple times. Every time a new one comes out,
I wonder if they're even doing that anymore. Because you know, think about the. Just technological jumps that we were seeing every few years, you and I as kids, right? And
oh yeah,
that's not that common.
Yeah, and it's very frustrating, like especially on the AAA level, to see see millions of dollars and thousands of man hours put into making a thing look pretty, which. Yeah. I guess is technically impressive, but it just is a complete zero to me. It's like, you could have spent that time and money in so many other better ways than just making your graphics look good.
Yeah.
There's already graphics that look good. What does this do?
Well, the other thing also is that it's such a wide spectrum now, even compared to the games that we had. I mean, we enjoyed lots of varied games in our teenage heyday, but even now it's like, such a broad scope of things. I mean, yes, we have the AAA super high graphic stuff that seems to need to be made, but at the same time, there's less ambitious games, even at the commercial level, games that are fairly modest in terms of their graphics or presentation or stuff. I am thinking of Natsumon as I say this, because I also finished Natsumon since we last talked about it. And that is a game that is like, it's an open world game that has some parts of the latest Zelda in it, but they're not trying to rebuild Zelda fully from the ground up. And it's like pretty rough around the edges, but knowing what it is and who it comes from, that's fine. Like it's a series of small companies that are not trying to build the biggest Nintendo type thing. It's just borrowing some stuff and trying to make a decent kind of open world game from that. And unambitious maybe in some respects, but that's fine. And so that is also like a top selling game because it came out in Japan in the summer and it's a summer vacation game. And of course people are into it and it got some social media clout because people were like, whoa, what? It's just like Breath of the Wild. You can climb on the train and stuff. And you know, that helps as well. But yeah.
Summer.
Didn't have a point. Just talking about Natsumon and how it was a little bit modest. That's all.
Would you say that you're nuts for Natsumon?
Not necessarily. No, it's a fun game. I put about 36 hours into it. Thank God it has a new game plus.
Well, you just start. Wait a minute. You start the game with a suntan?
No, I ended with one. That's for sure.
Well, that's what I'm saying. What do you do in new game plus?
Well, the story starts over, but you keep all the progress that you made in terms of like your stamina bar.
Okay.
You can choose things actually what you want to keep.
Oh, so wait, you start the game with foreknowledge of the stock market.
I don't think that's the point.
Is that okay?
But you keep all the bugs you had and the records of the bugs that you had. So.
All right. Bugs are hot.
And, you know, there's a lot of, you know, little subquests and big quests where collecting stuff and making sure that you do certain tasks earns you extra stamina on your stamina bar. And God, do you need it? Because there's like one challenge where you have to climb the 5 tallest structures in the game. And ironically, you only get one stamina upgrade from that, but you need a bunch of stamina to climb half of them. So it's pretty funny. I'm just grousing now.
Sounds like the game is bullying you into doing a dex build when that's not really the style that I play.
I'm afraid it's only dex.
What?
I mean, there's no health meter. There's no real, like.
What about, wait, what? How
no
viable
magic.
Is a. How viable? Oh, damn it! I was about to say, how viable is a magic build?
In fact, you just have a bug net just by default, but you never see it. You just push the bug net button. You don't have to go find one or anything.
Good.
You swing it and that's it. Yeah, well, yeah, that's good.
See, I like that. That's,
Yeah, no, same with the fishing rod and everything.
Yeah.
You can even find, like, little rock deposits and just press A on it, and all of a sudden, little Satoru would just pull out a pickaxe and pick it, and all of a sudden, you got, like, some gems to trade.
That's, I mean, I'm going to get into my big Sea of Stars thing in a minute, but that's one of the things I really appreciated about the game was when the first time you come upon a fishing hole, you just walk up to the fishing hole and you press the button and you start fishing. You cast the rod.
Okay.
There's no tutorial. There's no thing that's like, you've got to equip a rod. You've got to equip some bait. No, no, this is freshwater bait. You need to equip saltwater bait. There's none of that shit.
Natsumon does do that.
Please play the game. Oh, boy.
Natsumon does do that with the fishing. You got to walk up to the water source, pick your bait, and also the length at which you will throw out the rod, and then wait as you have little silhouettes of fish that might or might not jiggle your rod. Go ahead and isolate that.
Irritating stick.
I mean, that I'm not surprised that the developer headed by Yasuhiro Wada, the creator of Harvest Moon, would have just the most bog standard traditional fishing game controls you've ever seen in this game. So too bad on that, but the rest is okay in parts. Yeah.
Excellent.
And I complained before about the bus list and how there's really no idea of fast travel in a sense and blah. Anyway, I'm not really here to talk about games, so goodbye. No,
wait, come back.
I kind of had a second part to my school talk. This is a little bit longer. It's not fully related to school, but in the sense that I will be finishing this school and getting a degree at 40, and that does mean that I join the bunch of 21-year-olds who are now going to be entering the workforce. And trying to get a job. And I was thinking about getting a job after that and all because I kind of need one. And I may have had a mild revelation about myself. I may have finally reached a point of something. Now, I do want to caution. I do say stuff like this sometimes and it doesn't always pan out. Like, remember when I said I'd study for the JLPT, N5 at least or whatever? Like,
oh, yeah.
A few years ago on the show, I didn't even try. But
I mean, what do you need the JLPT for, though?
Personal growth.
Okay. I mean,
that was a good reaction.
No, but like, you can just study Japanese. The JLPT is for like, I need a qualification to apply for this job. Just study Japanese if you want personal growth.
No. Okay, Alex, at the time, I believe I was contextualizing it as, you know, before I had tried to study Japanese and really work out. But if I had some sort of, you know, paper goal.
Oh, some sort of goal. End, okay, yeah, I see. Okay.
I thought it would be a little bit there more motivating. Yes. It was not. But here's the thing. I had or have this anxiety hang up around asking people I know if they know where I can get a job, if it's with them or not or whatever. I mean, it's essentially like, I mean, my feelings are more complicated than this, trust me, but I think this boils down to me just not wanting to look stupid or weak or desperate.
Yeah.
And of course, you know, the rational part of the brain fights this, but when it comes out to typing out a message of some sort, like I just said, it's seize up time. But once again, I'm about to get a degree, the entire point of which was to help me get interviews, essentially. And I've been unemployed since I started this, since 2019. And I'm just going to have to get back to it. I haven't even mentioned the fact that I have a child now also. And so
do that. Put all of that information into one post. Just be like, I just had a kid. I just got my degree. Please help me get a job.
So, yeah, I mean, that's kind of what I was thinking. Some sort of post like that. But also, I'm looking at like November or December, just before school ends, of being like this sort of hunkering down and reaching out like that. Yeah. And I kind of asked my wife to be like my career coach and maybe smack some sense into me for this whole thing.
Sure.
But to get back to like the scaredy cat part, like as I've been thinking about that, I'm also kind of at the point where I'm now like, listen, I may not like being 40 and just getting a degree, but looking at everything I am right now, it's not like I have anything left. Like, where am I going? It's not like it was. You know, I'm not working for a game site where people see me on video or podcasts every week. I have some dinky video games that I ship that, yes, I did ship, but I've made maybe $1,500 off of all of it. And another one that still needs pushing over the finish line. And no idea how that's going to go. And no one's kicking my door down for any of this. None of my talents or anything. And I also stopped posting on Twitter. Finally on Blue Sky, though. We'll get to that later. Sure. And self-promotion is also kind of, you know, this thing I'm not great at. It's also another fear of looking stupid or bothering people. That sort of thing. And that's the feeling I've had, and I'm looking at all this again, and I guess I was starting to reach the realization that I don't know who else I can appear stupid to. And probably some of the people I know already thought I was a little dumb back then, so whatever. But hey, can you help an idiot out? So the real point is basically I feel like at least in the context of getting a job, maybe not life in general, but I might be slowly feeling like looking stupid just doesn't matter anymore.
No, it doesn't.
Because of everything that is now surrounding me and the fact that, you know, I don't – when I said I don't have anything left, I'm obviously not referring to my family. But it's just, you know, again, looking for a job in the career sense, like I just really don't have anything to show for it, I think, in a substantial sense. So in that sense also, it's just like, well, what else do I have? I don't care anymore. Just – yeah. I tried a bunch of stuff. It didn't work. I'm going to try this. You know, I'm going to try asking all of you again. So that sort of thing.
Yes. I think that's fine. That's a good mindset to have. Just don't build that into your actual appeal when you're writing or blogging or posting about
yes,
this.
Of course. I mean, yeah. One thing about turning 40, I'm a lot smarter about that sort of stuff.
Yeah. But,
and also, like, also in reviewing things for our other podcast, the Crunk Games podcast, I have seen a lot of material that I used to write and just like,
oh, God.
Kid, could you not?
I do not ever want to revisit any of my early stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, but like you said, yeah, some sort of post, maybe on LinkedIn or something. Yeah, one of those sorts of reach out things. The other factor in all this is that the economy blows and inflation right now. We seem it to does. Be in the midst of yet another glorious job market, just like we had in 2008 or 9. And I wasn't in school then, but now I am with a bunch of other school-aged people who will also be quite struggling with that. And so I guess me and Gen Z have something in common.
What if we could get the podcast big enough to where that's your job?
Is that what you want?
I mean, maybe.
You got to share in some of the responsibility.
I am so far.
Have you seen – I mean, I know you've mentioned getting on YouTube and stuff, but have you also seen just like the other sorts of podcasts that they have out there where it's like – a couple guys and a woman or something, and they just sit around a table and they all have microphones and you have no idea who these people are, but for some reason they have a podcast and they live in LA and they have a nice backdrop with a neon sign and they're posting
and they
clips
make
on
million
TikTok.
Dollars a month.
Yes. And
yeah.
They're posting their clips constantly. Again, you have no idea who these people are, why yeah. I'm supposed to like them or whatever, but they just keep posting these clips and it's just like, should we do that? I mean, should we get video going even though we live at different ends of the world? I mean,
yeah, I wouldn't mind doing that, but I can't help but think that a lot of the success of that kind of show is just pure parasocial phenomena from people who just like, well, I don't have much of a social life of my own, but I have a steady job and I make enough money, so I'm going to give money to these three friends and I like watching them talk and all. You know, it'll be like I got people in the room with me. And like I'm not saying that's necessarily a bad way to be, but I think that explains why shows like that are humongous for some weird reason.
Yeah. I'm not even sure they're humongous is the thing. I mean, they just still make keep tons posting of money. Shit and they show up in my For You page. Some of them, well, some of them no, but
I think that's also, well, yeah, I mean, that's how you get big, I think, is just constant nonstop output.
Yeah.
Like I tried to burst.
You need a team.
Burst. I tried to burst America or burst. I tried to
blue
boost. Thank you. I tried a Fantasy Star Online blue boost my Twitch channel by posting on TikTok, and I just, you know, I did it the way that I do everything. I just opened up YouTube and typed in how to do XYZ, how to succeed on TikTok, or no, how to promote your Twitch on TikTok, and I got a video that was like, you need to post 3 times a day.
Yeah.
Clips no longer than 12 seconds. And that was the that was the gist of the video, is 3 clips a day up to 12 seconds.
It's like posting news for websites again.
Yeah. And so I started going through all my old Twitch clips and they're all more than 12 seconds. So I'm like, okay. So I downloaded all the clips people had made. This is why I need people to make clips. Please, please make clips of my channel when funny things happen, because I can't do it while I'm streaming. And if you do, it will show up on TikTok, I promise.
No, you're not supposed to. It's supposed to be the viewers making clips.
I know, but ultimately, like, well, here's the thing. If I'm doing this I'm supposed to go through my own VODs and pick out funny bits. And like, that's thousands of hours that I'm not going through.
Yeah.
And so I did it for a couple of weeks. And then I realized, oh, if I do 3 a day, I'm going to run out of clips real soon. So I started doing 1 a day.
All right.
And I realized I was using a free service to make them TikTok format. Because here's the shitty thing about Twitch, and there's a lot. You can take your clips, and Twitch will automatically output them in TikTok/YouTube short resolution and format.
Oh, I didn't know that, but it does explain why I've seen so many ones with a similar template on it. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. And like, it knows where to put your face. It'll link back to your channel. It'll have your username all big and bright there. And it's great. Except for the fact that it condenses your sound down to like bullshit.
Oh, fantastic.
It condenses you down to a buzzing speaker box. And it's like, what's the point? Is the point of this?
Hey, everyone, I love FF6.
What is the point of this if you're just going to condense it down to bullshit? So now I do it all manually. I download the clips manually. I first have to put them into DaVinci Resolve, and I edit down the content to what I want the content to be. Then I upload that to a site that's only used for making TikTok shorts.
Yeah.
Then I download that short, upload it to TikTok and YouTube shorts.
Which, of course, should have been the thing you did from the beginning, right? Because it's like, well, I need to do it myself to do it halfway right.
Yes, and that's
the automatic tools aren't doing it.
that's how I know we are most of the time, is this automatic thing sucks, better do it manually. But the real kicker here is the fact that the site that I was using to make those TikTok clips only lets you do 15 a month unless you pay.
Yes, of
and,
course.
And that's when I'm like, I'm good doing one every other day. That's fine.
Yeah.
That's kind of where I am.
All right. You mentioned podcasts and parasocial relationships and all that. I got to say, I'm relieved that we never got too parasocial.
No.
We never so much as got a Reddit for us.
No, there is a Nomo Reddit, I think. And I think the only post is like, when does this show? Yeah. Do you remember this? You don't remember this?
No. You heard about this, Kev?
Somebody made a No More Whoppers Reddit. And I'm pretty sure the only post is like, when does the show get good? I think this was like 10 years ago. Oh, is it gone? Good. Okay. Yeah. Fuck that. We don't need a subreddit.
I think it got auto deleted or something.
Good. Cause I do. I do. I have Reddit on my phone for killing time at work, just scrolling through FF14 shit usually.
Mm-hmm.
And it keeps recommending me. So, you know, it does that every fucking day based on your activity. We think you'd like this. And it keeps pushing the Laser Time subreddit on me and the Talking Simpsons subreddit on me. And both subreddits are just filled with people who hate those shows. Yes. And I don't understand. I don't understand why you would form a community just to hate on a thing that you supposedly like. It's fucking bizarre.
It is bizarre that's like the default approach to a lot of people. It's just like to go in and bitch about it.
Yeah.
And then it's also bizarre that then the onus is kind of on us to add moderation and to then foster a community of at least, you know, nice people. And I think you have something where you have a lot of giant podcasts, YouTubers, streams, and all sorts of other shows where it's like, yeah, people are generally okay because the chaff has been so separated from the wheat that you can't even see it anymore. But if you do go to a 2-bit subreddit that was just put up, you know, for shits and giggles, you're just going to get shits and giggles. So, yeah.
Yeah.
That's the online community rodeo.
That's
but
right.
Again, not to make it sound like I'm shocked that we don't have fans, but it's more like I'm just glad that we don't have a lot of very obsessed fans.
Yes, we do. We have great fans. I think that's kind of the appeal of this show is we are not a wild success, but I will say that pretty much all the fans we have are chill and smart and nice and, you know, put up with me yelling at, through, or by them.
Yeah, I'm also a little bit traumatized because I worked at 1UP.com, and before that, I think we'll talk about next time on the Crunk Game Show, where we had a forum and people just abused it and posted nasty things on it because I guess we weren't fully liked yet. And so, like, stuff like that, I'm just like, yeah, it's not always worth having a community.
No. Yeah. No, it's okay to have things that are just meant to be like passively enjoyed.
Yeah.
Like if when I go to the movie, like I don't want to see a scrolling comment section as I'm watching Oppenheimer. You know what I mean?
Yes.
Like that's not
the Nico version of Oppenheimer.
Just text scrolling above the image, like as the bomb goes off. Just a string of W's.
I'm sure you saw all those news stories recently where, you know, Japan was sort of mad at Warner Brothers for sort of promoting the Barbenheimer thing. It's like, I can't believe they didn't like that. I'm so surprised that maybe Japan doesn't really like the concept of the Oppenheimer movie to begin with.
I mean, it's still a historical drama. I mean, it's touching on a very sensitive topic, but I don't think it's glorifying it in any way. I mean, I haven't seen it, so I can't.
I mean, it's not a thing you would want to joke about in front of Japan, you know?
Right.
I mean,
that much is definitely true.
I did see Barben though. I did see that movie, so I saw half of the promotion.
Wait, what is what?
You didn't get it? You didn't get it?
No. What's Barben?
Barbenheimer.
I know.
I saw the Barben part.
Okay. All right. All right. Fine.
You're done.
I get
you
it.
With me now?
Yeah. Well, while you were doing that, I was hanging out with Barbon, the first boss in Streets of Rage.
Okay. Too far. Too far. God, the Barbie movie, that was good. Yeah.
I haven't seen it. No, I'd like
all right.
to.
All right. That had a different controversy associated with it because Vietnam got
mad. Oh, the China
mad.
Thing? Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's right.
Yeah. And then I think the Philippines, by extension, was just like, yeah, this sucks.
Oh, boy.
Which is weird because I think that map in the movie did not seem to be CG. I thought it did, you know, at first when I read the news stories and stuff. They seemed to be, like, composited in, but I think it was actual practical effect, which is even weirder. Because, like, you know, your natural assumption would be, well, I guess some Chinese VFX artist got that in there or something. Anyway, not here to discuss Barbie controversies.
I'm a loaf! I'm a loaf! Barb traversies?
Judges? No, I'm shaking my head.
Hang on. Wait, no, wait. Let me ask my judges. They're partial to me. Judges? Fuck!
Canadian sex secrets.
All right.
So, okay. To circle back to my story, yeah, I think I'm just like, I don't know how much stupider I can seem, but I need something to happen, and so I have to ask for help,
fine.
And whether I look stupid or not, yeah, something needs to happen.
Don't worry. I mean, we're now firmly in an age where I see pleas for help on social media every day. Hey, I need help paying medical bills. Hey, yeah. I lost my job unfairly. Hey, I'm 100% yeah. being discriminated against. Can I get a little help here? And that's yeah. fine. And
I know,
I think
but
it's, you know.
You know, the dumb mental process for someone with anxiety like me is like, but that's not me. I'm different. I'm the guy who was special. And so I, you know.
Well,
it's just, you know, you have to fight that, obviously. It's, yes. it's an anxiety thing that I've been fighting for 30 years.
Yeah. You're a guy who has bills to pay, and you got this kid who is just running around town, causing all sorts of trouble.
He's a troublemaker.
You got just spit out the bottom of a collapsing industry, and you gotta get that bread. Is that what they say?
Yeah, bread or bag. Yeah.
Get that bag.
I think bag is the more hipper way to put it now, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, so, go get a bag.
No, get the bag.
Okay.
I don't know what the bag is. Just get it.
Is it like a Louis Vuitton?
Probably, yeah.
All right.
Also get this.
The warrant!
No!
But you need it to help find Carmen.
I have not been deputized to do any of this. Why is it my responsibility to find Carmen? What kind of surname is San Diego? Is her middle name San?
First of all, you're not a deputy. You're a gumshoe. You're an acne gumshoe. You've been tasked to help us find Carmen.
Is her middle name San?
I don't think so. It's just her, part of her last name, San Diego.
Is San Diego one word?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. You get it? You with us?
More or less.
Hold it, Pituli.
Thank you. Thanks, Regis. I've been playing a video game called Sea of Stars. Raymond, have you heard about this?
Yes, I have had it. We discussed it and how we were not all that enthused about it at the time.
Yeah, I went on and off about it. At first, it was a zero because I thought it was going to be another Chained Echoes. It was another indie RPG love letter to JRPGs that's just crammed full of references.
Turns out
I was only half right.
Okay.
There is actually...
I like those odds.
There are traits of a competent game under there.
All righty.
But at first, I was like, no.
I get you so far, yeah.
And then our pal Maddie was excited about it, and I'm like, well, she
well,
seems to
Maddie.
Have good taste in games, so I got a little bit excited for it.
Maddie's
then
a tastemaker.
Yes. Then I heard, yeah, nobody had heard of this whole Metal Gear thing, and then Maddie starts streaming them. It's doing boffo bucks now. And then I heard about the Jordan Peterson stuff, and I lost interest again. Catch folks up, there was like a string of like, not a string, some hidden messages in the Messenger, which is Sabotage
well,
Studios'
technically
previous
a string.
Game.
Yeah, programming.
All right. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks, nerd.
You're welcome.
All right. There was some messages in, appropriately enough, the game The Messenger
mm-hmm.
that were basically just kind of extolling the virtues of Jordan Peterson's ethos and life advice. And I heard about that and I was like, oh, so Sabotage Studios are big Jordan Peterson fans? I lost interest in Sea of Stars. And then I'm glad somebody did this though. Somebody actually asked the devs directly, hey, what the fuck was up with that?
Yeah.
You gonna answer for that? And they were like, yeah, it's a bunch of different reasons. Like it was from years ago before they kind of knew he was, even though he's kind of been known as a garbage person for a while.
He's famously a shithead, yes.
Messenger came out in 2018, but maybe they had put that in the game earlier before it was released. I mean, long before. They said they were basically at a low point and they really took to his self-help stuff before he was more open about his shitty opinions, and they kind of didn't realize he would become such a garbage monster. And they were asked outright, like, are you into him now? And they said, absolutely not.
All right. Yeah. Once again, in our most recent episode of Crunk Games, you were talking about how you were kind of into Scott Adams' way of thinking about
it's like that.
Affirmations. Though, why you have so many Scott Adams references in your RPG? And why are you calling it Scott Adams Densetsu?
Oh, no. I didn't realize I had uploaded that prototype to the server, but it seems you've seen it. So,
your ass I'm is actually, grass now.
Well, we're probably going to change. It's probably going to become a skateboarding RPG. The world's first skateboarding RPG called Ska Adams. We've got who do we have? Tokyo Ska Paradise Orchestra is doing the soundtrack.
Yeah. Good. Great.
Sorry. No, special guest composers. A la Yasunori Mitsuda. Special guest composer of Sea of Stars. What the fuck was I talking about?
Sorry.
Oh, right. Okay. No, it's fine. So I was worried that maybe they were kind of like alt-right weirdos, and it turns out, no, they just didn't know any better. And I think it's like, if somebody makes a mistake or needs to be corrected, like, I don't think we need to jump down their throats immediately. I think you can give people time to sort of come clean about stuff. Like, I think it's counterproductive. And I hate, this is going to come out wrong, and I don't mean it like this.
Okay.
Please don't take this the wrong way.
Okay, I promise.
We don't need to cancel everybody immediately.
Okay. I see what you're saying.
This is not an Adam Carolla style decrying of quote unquote cancel culture. Cause I think when shitbags do bad things, yes, hold people accountable. But also, if someone's young and stupid and says something young and stupid, it's fine. Just let them, give them a chance to apologize and you know, make it right. Like, talking about our old stuff in the Crunk podcast, so guess who is fucking filling the chat box with ableist homophobic language every fucking day? It was us, because we were in fucking 19.
Yeah.
Right? But we don't do that anymore. Because we know it's not a good thing to do.
Yeah. And we will have an episode mostly about that, I think.
Good. I'm looking forward to it.
But I think in the case of the Messenger stuff, it was just sort of there and discovered, and there was no like prior evidence from the creators. Like, okay, if somebody's posting any kind of Jordan Peterson stuff, you can usually go not too far. You can take a couple clicks and see the kind of things they have posted before that.
The
kind of things they like, have clicked like on, and sort of get a pretty good idea that, it's just, you can kick him to the curb, basically.
Yeah.
In the case of the Messenger, though, I don't think there was a lot of that. There was no, like, the dude was not espousing Jordan Peterson stuff during all that. It was just he inserted into the game as what he thought was an admiring reference or whatever. But but it also in that case, like, hey, it just does help to ask, it turns out.
Yes.
And let someone explain themselves. And if they don't explain themselves and do go off and become just a chud in your face, then
it's okay to just ask someone, hey, what did you mean by this?
Yeah.
Instead of immediately going, you know, right to, oh, we need to cancel this person immediately.
And also saying things like, do better.
Do better is one of my favorites.
Yeah. Like,
do better. Okay.
Just, which is an immediate writing off. I know the people who use it think they are helping, but it's just like, whenever you're just like, I can't believe you would say this, do better. It's just like, you've just pushed the person away. you haven't really given them a chance, and just like seeing that externally just bugs me. But
yeah, do better is the best language to use when you want to like really, really make an effort to pretend like you care for this person's well-being and their output. You don't. You've already decided you hate them.
Like, could you make it sound less like a demand, please? Or an order.
Look, do better on my desk by 7 p.m.
Simon says do better. Right. Well.
And the content of the Jordan Peterson stuff in the Git, like they were sticking to his self-help stuff and not his reprehensible, these people aren't human beings stuff, which can, you know, kind of is why most alt-right weirdos latch on him in the first place.
But back to Sea of Stars, other observations you had. I saw some of your comments on the Discord. I don't know if you want to recall any of that. But,
Let's go back to the Star Ocean. Started out off board, got on board, was off board again, and then I was on board again. And, you know, after they came out and sort of
where's the board now?
It's on my wall now. It's a dream board.
Okay.
After they sort of explained themselves a bit, I was like, all right, you know what? Let's enjoy. I haven't played a good 2D RPG in a long time.
True.
Let's enjoy one. Let's just go in positively and have fun. And I started up, and I think for about the first couple hours, I was really enjoying most of it. I think it was like a solid 9, just a lot, just beautiful graphics. Most of the music was good. They got Yasunori Mitsuda he's cited as guest composer. I think he did 12 tracks total. I can't tell which are his. I don't know what that means. I don't know if that means whoever is doing the rest of the music is doing great or if Yasunori himself was just phoning it in. I don't know. It all sounds like average RPG music to me. Chrono Trigger has a great soundtrack, but one of the reasons it sticks out is because it's connected to Chrono Trigger and you were 12.
Yeah, and I think we talked about that before, where it's like you kind of need direction as a musician for the project.
And I'm sure they had correspondence and direction, but I don't know what that direction was, because what it sounds like that direction was like, do a forest one.
Yeah.
You know, like, all right, sure.
Send an email to Kazayabe, like, do it in the winter.
All right, well, it's highly unorthodox.
He did want to do one in the winter, I just want to say.
Oh. But the rest of the game is super solid. I the first couple hours I was really into it, and I still kind of am. It's not a bad game,
right.
But after a while, it's settled into like maybe a 6 or 7 overall, because there's a couple of minor annoyances, but it's still fine. There's a timed hit system which Maddie loves, and I just can't do. I hate timed hits. Fortunately, there's optional, like there's these relics that you can toggle on and off that make the game easier. I just turned them all on because I just want to get through it to see what it's all about.
Yeah, that's the modern way.
And some of those are just, it'll do the timed hits for you at slightly reduced damage. All right, that's fine.
Yeah, cool.
I think my only real gripes are just the story and the character and the writing. Like that, my biggest complaint about the messenger was the writing is, I hate to use this term. The writing was very cringe. It was not great. It felt like a meme script that you unlock after beating the game once.
Buddy, I've not heard great things about the messenger. Another like makes a real great first impression because pixel art, and then like the rest of it is just kind of a slog.
That's the thing. Like, if you're going for that Ninja Gaiden vibe, like visually, I think it looks great, but then you try to make it a little too clever with your dialogue.
Have some good old cognitive dissonance. Why not?
Yeah. Sea of Stars is significantly better written than The Messenger, but still not very good.
Well, better than nothing, I suppose.
Like, a lot of the dialogue that is like supposed to be serious is fine. Like a lot of the you know, townsperson NPC dialogue is great.
Yeah.
A lot of the exposition when important things are happening, that's fine. I guess maybe I just don't like their sense of humor. It's anytime the game tries to be funny or witty, it's just groaner after groaner after groaner, which I'm not a huge fan of.
Mm-hmm.
Also, just a lot of mistakes, errors, typographical errors. Sabotage
now that
is a team.
I know that you hate the most.
Yeah, Sabotage is a team out of Quebec, I believe, and I don't know if they had a Quebecois write it and they just didn't give it a pass, have a native English speaker give it a pass.
I know
English is spoken there. That's my assumption. I did actually look this up while I was playing the game. Only half of Quebec, I believe, speaks English. Hey, I don't make the stats, man.
So okay.
I don't know. I mean, it's playable. It's readable. It's fine. It's just there's enough small mistakes that it's like, I mean, you could have had someone else look this over. There have been two examples of like $5 thesaurus words that have no reason to be in there.
Okay.
There are two words that I had to look up because I did not know what they meant.
It's like,
which I think may just be another instance of like,
it's like the package on a bootleg toy.
Yeah. It's like, I'm sure this is like a French cognate that makes sense to you. This is not a word that's commonly used in English. And it also doesn't fit coming out of the character's mouth because none of the other vocabulary used by this character is anywhere near this word.
Mm-hmm.
And it feels very out of place.
Yeah. Dialogue and, you know, translation / localization is, I think, still a big bugbear for indie games.
Yes.
It's like still something that needs a lot of work. And
that's like, that's my jam is I'm good with words. Put me to work. Anybody who needs dialogue for a video game, down. Put me down.
Hey, you can try and be a narrative designer. That's basically the job now. You can do that.
Is that a job?
Yes.
Oh, shit.
It basically means writer for games, but
okay.
Yeah.
Well, maybe that's how I'll make my game because I don't have any of the other disciplines down.
All right.
I can write.
Let's do some narrative, I guess.
All right. Because I was like this game and Sea of Stars and Chained Echoes both served to energize me a little bit more about making my own RPG because I see what these studios in indie studios are doing. And outside of the visuals and the music, I'm mm-hmm. thinking I can do much better than this.
Yeah.
There's like I shared my script with you a couple of years ago or my outline.
Right. Scott Adams then says
that. Yes. Just shut up. he hasn't signed off on the license yet.
Okay.
I've negotiated for the Japanese title to be Dirubato Monogatari. So look forward.
Fantastic. Okay.
Okay. And his companion Inubato.
Now with extra racism.
No.
Oh.
And like I want to emphasize, Sea of Stars is a good game. I think overall, it's much better than Chained Echoes because Chained Echoes just hits you from the start with too much lore dump, too many proper nouns, and too many references to other games.
Was this the one that had like the giant intro crawl of like setup?
Yeah, and a game that literally opens in Chrono's bedroom, like it's Chrono's bedroom. They just did it in their engine, and it's a dream sequence, and you wake up, and you're not actually in Chrono's bedroom, but you knew what it was. You know what I'm talking about, right? You're a nerd, right? You like Chrono Trigger? Yeah, we all do.
Thanks
we
for all like Chrono for the Trigger. Game. Bye now.
I'm tempted to name my game "We All Like Chrono Trigger." Shut the fuck up.
Yeah, it could be the subtitle.
It's not a bad idea. Sea of Stars is not nearly as bad with the references. There are a few. There's a bunch of Chrono Trigger references, but I'll run them down here. You have a combo attack called X Strike. There's another attack called Slurp Kiss. There's an NPC looking over a valley who says mountains are nice. It's not much more than that. They're not intrusive. It's not like Chained Echoes where it's every 5 minutes. It's like, hey, remember this from FF9? Hey, remember this from FF Tactics? Remember this from FF6? Yeah, I do.
Yeah, I know why.
Hey, everyone, I love FF6. I do. We know this.
Yeah. Established.
Sea of Stars is not afraid to rely more on its own world and its own story, which I do like. Even though the story's getting a little complicated to follow, I don't think I quite understand what's going on. I certainly don't understand a couple of characters' motivations. The game hasn't really explained that yet. I'm sure they will.
As long as they explain it in English.
Yeah. But the battle system's fine. I like running around. I like exploring. Dungeon puzzles are pretty good.
The puzzle dungeon puzzles?
Puzzle dungeon puzzles are pretty puzzle.
All right, good.
I've heard to get the best ending, you have to collect all 60 of these rainbow shells, which that's kind of annoying because apparently some of them are missable. Game doesn't really tell you that.
Oh, boy. Well, hey, better than you could be playing Natsumon and have to collect all 200 insects.
Oh, God.
I'm missing 25, and I think the rest are Beatles.
Okay.
I'm 25 away, but you have to, like, lure Beatles out. You have to put honey on trees and shit. It's ridiculous.
Man.
I digress.
Speaking of Beatles and Chrono Trigger, I had a stupid Blue Sky post retweeted by Retronauts, thank you very much, but in doing so, exposed it to hundreds of
opinionated enthusiasts
who had to correct my joke.
Ah, good to see Blue Sky's carrying on Twitter's legacy there.
Yes. I mean, really, it was, that doesn't mean they all were. There was one annoying person, and then there were a couple more who were, God, what was my joke? It was like, because I was playing Sea of Stars, and I was thinking, like, wow, can you imagine what indie RPGs would be like without Chrono Trigger? So I made a post that was like...
movie idea. Imagine. Yesterday, 20... Yeah, excuse me, I'll read
yeah,
it
yeah,
less
yeah,
fast.
Read it.
Movie idea. Yesterday, 2019. But it's about an indie dev who wakes up in a world in which Chrono Trigger was never released.
Yes. So the film Yesterday was about a guy who wakes up in a world where the Beatles never existed. So he writes all their songs and becomes popular. And I'm imagining, like... what that would be like with indie devs and without Chrono Trigger, because it seems to influence every indie RPG that there is.
Yeah.
And I was saying this in the context of Sea of Stars, because I had written and deleted a bunch of drafts about Sea of Stars and how much it loves Chrono Trigger. And yeah. I settled on that. And then because I didn't specifically mention Sea of Stars, the first response is just, wouldn't this be funnier with Earthbound? Thanks. We're not workshopping my jokes. Please get blocked and stay blocked.
Wow.
And then there were two other guys who were like, yeah, it's called growing up in Europe. This was our reality. And I'm like, I didn't engage. I just muted them. But I was thinking, like, really? You guys didn't get ROMs in the 90s? Are you fucking, like, you're missing the point. You're willfully being obtuse, you fuck.
Here's the thing about the Earthbound one is that it can also be Earthbound, because
yes,
Earthbound and Chrono Trigger are now the only two Super NES games anyone remembers, anyone wants, anyone plays. So yeah, it doesn't have to be just Earthbound.
Yeah.
It can also be Chrono Trigger, because that's it. That's all that we've decided to remember.
Yeah, it's frustrating.
Everybody who's like, get a Mister or get one of these retro handhelds so I can play Chrono Trigger on it.
For 5 minutes.
Yeah. It's still going on. It is still a thing, brother.
All right, I'm getting in the weeds here. But Sea of Stars is fine. It is, I don't think it's very long. I think I'm more than halfway through it. I think I'm 12 hours in.
All right.
I think my the only complaint I have really, like narratively, is none of the characters really – remember we were talking about how Venture Brothers has a great cast that grows and changes and has arcs. This has none of that.
No arcs, huh?
I know that's – you know, it's harder to do that in a limited span of time. Venture Brothers had 7 seasons and a movie in which to do that, and Sea of Stars, mm-hmm. I guess, has 20 to 30 hours.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But true. It's – there's one character who has a kind of like toxic positivity that's really getting on my fucking nerves. your main two characters are basically kid ciphers. They're just like, we were chosen to do this task, so let's do it. Okay, cool. And then you've got a ninja girl, which she's all right. Fine, I guess. But
is she spunky?
Yeah. No, not spunky enough, right?
Oh. Oh, okay.
Nothing happens with these characters other than this journey is inflicted on them.
Wow, geez.
You know?
Your ninja girl's not spunky. What kind of reference is that?
And the most of the dialogue is very much just like, this is what I think dialogue is supposed to be. Remember the first episode of our Crunk cast? I said this about like creative endeavors and writing about video games and making content about video games, how most people just, they don't do things that are interesting. They do the thing they think they're supposed to do. That's what a lot of Sea of Stars feels like, especially the dialogue. It's like, well, this is what I think RPG dialogue is. This is what I think this is supposed to be. And
right.
It is, it looks like it and it behaves like it, but it's not doing anything.
But is it a duck?
Kinda.
I was hoping the answer was no.
Like it's the kind of thing that I play and I'm like, yeah, technically you made an RPG, I guess. But I mean, they mention Chrono Trigger in the Steam description of the game.
Yes.
Like why are you doing that to yourselves? You know this isn't Chrono Trigger. Yeah. You know I'm not 12 and I'm not going to enjoy this the same way.
I gave my opinion on that stuff last time, but yeah.
And what was that? Recap that for us.
Well, my whole thing about that is like, I don't like it when you wear that on your sleeve.
Yeah.
When you're promoting your game like that. I know it will capture a certain subset of dullards, but when it comes to actually like giving your game a sense of worth and value, I think you're just diluting it. And it's not the kind of marketing I would do for that kind of game.
Yeah, diluting is a good word. Yeah.
That was the gist of it.
Like imagine if somebody, like a sci-fi, like Star Wars type movie today that was not Star Wars, but they kept referencing Star Wars in the marketing. What are you going to think when you watch that?
I mean, that's just my opinion. I'm not the one making money off the thing, so.
Right. I mean, obviously, this works on people.
Yeah.
But it's just, yeah. Yeah, dilute is a good word, because that's what it's doing. Like, I think overall the game is good, despite being a love letter, which love letter, I think, being my most hated subgenre of video game.
Yeah. But you can't keep that phrase out of your head and the other phrases, because now you've read it and heard it.
Yeah. It only exists in reference to the better thing.
Yeah. And it is affecting how you are playing it.
Yeah.
I don't like that. I think it's kind of a bummer.
But I don't know how, you know, my own game will turn out, because in my mind, it is kind of a love letter to Suikoden 2 and Illusion of Gaia and other RPGs. You know, not the popularity of Chrono Trigger or Earthbound, but to me, they were very meaningful. And I'm going to certainly borrow certain elements from these games, but I'm not going to mention these games when I talk about it. I'm just going to, you know, hey, if you played Suikoden 2, you'll recognize this. If you played Illusion of Gaia, you'll recognize this.
A love letter with.
Yes, I feel like when you describe your game as a love letter, you are limiting any kind of like artistic reach that you would otherwise possibly have.
Yeah. Yep.
Because again, you're only existing in reference to another thing instead of being a wholly original experience. And maybe that's fine. That's fine for some developers and some gamers is, yeah, I just want a thing that's going to make my brain feel like it's playing an old game for a little while.
I just want to bang on the drum all day.
Yes, but that's not enough. you gotta want to reinvent the drum.
Drum's pretty fun, though.
It is pretty fun.
Well.
Anyway, I think at the end of the day, it's a solid six and a half. I don't know. I don't really rate or review games anymore, but
and it's on Xbox Game Pass, so
that's why I'm playing it. Yeah, I'm not. I have
doesn't
not spent
matter.
Money. Yeah, there's also that.
Boot it up and give it a shot.
It's also, and this is sort of related to what we were talking about way earlier, but like there nothing. It's unfair because this game could never be a 10 out of 10 for me, because no game can, because I'm 40 now.
Yeah.
There's no game that's going to change my life the way that, you know, FF6 did in 1994.
Yeah.
And that's fine. Video games, I think, to me now are only a distraction anymore. There's nothing they can do really to, I don't know, impact me. Because I've just seen, I don't want to say I've seen it all, but like I've played enough games where everything is just like, yeah, I get it.
Yeah.
And I hate that, but that's part of growing up and getting old, is just you see so much shit that you're left with just, yeah, I get it.
I guess I'm a bit more inured to it just based on how much I've followed video games in my life to begin with.
I agree. But, you are a nerd.
Thanks. I've seen Super Mario Brothers Wonder, and I was like, boy, you know, that looks really cool. I'm glad they put some new art in it, and it kind of has like you know, the font stylings and some of the character designs there sort of evocative of the classic sort of Mario style of the 80s and 90s that we're familiar with, and things that they couldn't exactly replicate on the game screen at the time. But I know I'm just going to get it and play it and blow through it as fast as I can and enjoy it as much I can through that way, but still not like with any kind of childlike wonder.
I still do really like platformers because they are good time killers, not to be confused with the game time killers. No. But yeah, my approach to those, as it has always been, is blow through the game as fast as possible and then go back to the beginning and get every collectible. And that's fine. That's how I like to do it. That's how I do your Donkey Kong countries, your Yoshi's Islands.
Mm-hmm.
I think the only game I gave up doing that was New Super Mario Brothers 2 because Jesus Christ.
I guess what I'm saying is I'm too good at Mario games.
I know you are.
Yeah.
But what am I?
Too good at Final Fantasy VI.
Oh. Yeah, I got a Ragnarok sword.
What if they made an FF6 platformer?
It's not the best sword. No.
All right.
Yeah, I've thought about this. Like, people at the bar will sometimes ask me, like, don't you want to see an FF6 remake, like FF7 remake? No!
Mm.
Why on fucking planet Earth would I want that?
You're not a guy who wants remakes of things to begin with.
Yeah, like, if I want a remake, it's a 2D pixel remaster, or, you know, not a straight-up...
Or it's something that will boot on my modern PC.
Yeah, right.
Without any sort of hang-ups.
give me a modern HD remaster of DQ8 on Steam, please, Square Enix. I'm begging you. I mean, the 3DS remake of DQ7 is a good remake. I mean, I don't hate all remakes, but there has to be, I don't know.
Dragon Quest kind of earns it, though, in a way, because...
What do you mean?
It's so infrequent. With them?
Yeah, that's true.
Like, yeah, they don't do it unless they need to, right? Like, it wasn't until the DS came out, and it was like, well, we can do 4, 5, and 6 now, and then...
Well, I mean, they did 1, 2, and 3 on the Super Famicom.
Yeah.
You know?
I mean...
What's up?
I didn't explain my point well enough, but I agree with you, yeah. I know what's going on. I know what you're saying.
And we should be getting another... 2D HD remaster or remake of 3 on the Switch, which I believe we're coming up on the 10-year anniversary of when it was announced.
You know, it's almost time for the Tokyo Game Show. I feel like that might be a time to talk about that again for them. We'll see.
Oh, that would be nice.
Yeah. I think we'll have some fun stuff around TGS time.
Would
have happened already by the time we have this, I think.
I kind of have a theory that the game is done and has been done for a long time, but Square Enix's release schedule is just so full of stuff they can't find a place to cram it in because they know it's a big deal because it's Dragon Quest.
That is very believable.
Because it was announced over 2 years ago. It was announced for the series' 35th anniversary, for fuck's sake.
Yeah.
And like, I don't know much about game development. I do know they're using that Octopath engine, which is good to go and has been used in several games.
Well, that is questionable. The Octopath engine is just Unreal Engine, and I think all the games that have been made in that style have been from different developers and not exactly adhered to the exact look of Octopath. But yes, the HD 2D trappings are there.
Right.
You could be right. I think they could be finding the perfect time to finally... drop it on us. You know, Fire Emblem Engage was the last Fire Emblem game. Apparently Nintendo was sitting on that probably for up to a year. There was like leaked screenshots that from months prior to that game coming out. This is just an example. Like, Nintendo also sat on the new 1-2 Switch game because apparently focus tests were hating it, and so they just like sat on it for a year until they kind of farted it out right before they had a Nintendo Direct. And, I mean, it happens. It is part of the business. And certainly Square Enix would definitely have the wherewithal to hold back on Dragon Quest III, probably just spend some time polishing it. Again, sort of like Nintendo did with Tears of the Kingdom. I think they held that back for a year just to, like, polish the physics and just make a good enough splash with it. Yeah, I think you're right.
And that's fine, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't mind. Hang on. Back it up for a sec. Can I still play Fire Engine? Fire Engine?
I'm Alex.
Excuse me. Can I still play Fire Emblem Engage if I don't own an N-Gage?
No. What, are you an idiot?
Yes. Oh, You know, the more I think about making my own game and the fact that all I have is the narrative, the more I think, like, should I just write a book? Should I just make a visual novel? Like, why does it have to be a video game?
Yeah.
Like, what is it about that format that draws me to it? I think it's because it's just a slow, controlled narrative with some battles. Is that it?
You can make that post you did on Blue Sky into an isekai light novel.
Maybe I will.
I woke up in a world where game developers no longer have a concept of Chrono Trigger and don't know how to make new role-playing games anymore. And also, I've been reincarnated as a
boob.
Wave XLR.
Help, I'm a Wave XLR. What was that?
And I live in a dungeon.
That time I was reincarnated as boobs.
Don't give them ideas.
My God, I did a yeah. Oh, I got another job request from the guy who wanted me to do all those Mushoku Tensei videos.
Ah, yeah, right.
I don't know if it's going to be the same, but we'll find out.
Okay. Best of luck.
Anyway, thank you.
Any other updates on the voice acting thing other than changing your business license?
No, right. I don't think so. Nothing I can disclose at this time.
How about you write your RPG story and then voice act it?
Just like make my own audiobook?
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, because the music's going to be part. I mean, that's part of a good RPG is all the elements come together, the music and the story
music?
And the visuals in a book?
I guess an audiobook, sure, yeah.
Huh, all right. Well, I don't have any songs, so I'm just going to loop the theme from Double Dare over and over in the background. Right. All right. Name of the game is Triple Dare.
Will this work? Let's see.
Yeah, there we go. All right. Chapter 1. Damascus raised his battle axe over the defeated Captain Blorbo. I have you now, he shouted sternly. Suddenly, the boat capsized, and both men were plunged into the jaws of the Atsugiri T-Rex.
Why a T-Rex?
You may be thinking. The king of the ocean, the scourge of the waves. Oh. The crack of the bat. All right. That's chapter one. You get that one for free.
Great, thank you. subscribe to my Patreon.
Oh, boy. Hey, thanks for subscribing to ours.
Hey, yeah.
Yeah. Hey!
Well,
all right. I think that's all I have for game talk.
I think
Sea of Stars
almost all we have for podcast talk.
Well, we still got to take a break.
And I say this on the edge of not knowing what the future holds. You got to check our voicemail.
Ooh, let's do it. Wait, let's take a break first and then check the voicemail. How about that?
Yeah, no, that's part of the thing. Yeah, cool. That's what I meant.
Bye. Okay, BRB. Kira-kira-re.
Folks, we're back. It's No More Whoppers. I'm Ray, and that is always Alex.
Bleep lorp.
Nearly time to shut it down, but of course, we must check on the voicemails.
That's right. You can call us. What's the number?
805-NMW-TALK. In normal numbers, that is 805-669-8255.
I was going to say, yeah, what if my phone doesn't have fancy letters on? I got to call 805-669-8255?
I know your phone has letters on it.
You don't know what kind of phone I have.
You have an iPhone SE.
SE 2! See, I knew you didn't know what kind of phone I have.
Got me again.
I knew it.
Damn, he's good.
Give us a call. We want to hear your voice. Tell us.
You don't need to.
we want to. We want it's you to tell us stories. Starting with this first one, I believe this is from our pal Franco Chan.
Why you always got to give up the name? Why don't you let them introduce themselves?
Fine. This is from our friend Redacted.
Okay.
And I'm going to hit play, and we're going to bask in this. So here we go.
Hey, Ray and Alex. It's Franco Chan from the Philippines. Just wanted to say that I really love the show. Thanks for all your updates. Snack food copies, always fun. I recently got back into inline skating.
Okay.
I did so because I haven't skated since 1998. Sometime there. And it feels great because my new wheels have like a pretty good diameter. There's like an 80 millimeter diameter by a durometer. And with the way I skate, I like skating big wheels. I don't really grind. So, one of my idols is Chris Edwards from the X Games, and he used to skate for Rollerblade, and he was a stunt double for the 90s movie Airborne. I don't know if you guys see it.
Postal code 444-0116. Sorry,
you can. Nukatagun, Kotas Cho.
Oh,
Atashino.
Oh, yeah.
With Seth Green.
Atashino Ju Hachibanchi.
Midoregaoka Village F202. That's my full fucking address.
All right, thank you, Franco-chan.
You just see the teacher standing in front of the audience with making a little rolling motion with her fingers, like.
Yeah, okay. Let me get this out. First of all, thank you for calling in. We always appreciate calls. Second of all, folks, please have something that you want to address or talk about and not Canada stalls on trade packs. But thank you. I believe I play drops over
Canada
this.
Canada stalls on wheel diameter.
Talking about Chris Edwards from the X Games. I've not seen the 90s movie Airborne. I don't know who Mitchell Goosen is. I've heard of Cincinnati. I know who Seth Green is. I think Devil's Backbone is a skateboard trick. That's all I know. I'm trying to piece clues together, context clues rather. But thank you for the call. Franco and his wife did visit the bar a couple years ago. I think pre-pandemic. They were very nice.
Very nice.
Well, back when I was still drinking, they gave me a bottle of this rum called Don
Wow.
Something. Back when I did right. drink, it was it was a very good rum that tasted very vanilla-y.
All right, yeah, it's a good combo.
Yes. So, I mean, look, I can't get mad. Technically, it was under 90 seconds, that phone call.
True.
But I think this is nudging me towards now a new sub-60 format. I think we're going to have to start keeping it under 60 seconds because holy shit.
Turns out 90 seconds... It was a bit longer than we thought.
Turns out 90 seconds can also be interminable. Thank you, Franco.
Next call.
All right. We've got a beautiful 42-second call here coming right up. I'm going to hit play on call number two.
Hey, this is Griffin from South Carolina. Long-time listener, first-time caller. I just wanted to say, this isn't over and over or anything else like that. Just the fact that I've been listening to you guys forever, ever since episode one. And it's just radical to see that you guys are still doing this. When I first started listening, I was a donor pizza delivery driver. And now I'm engaged and I'm an engineer. And it's just fucking rad. And I've spent so much time listening to you guys. And you guys have brought me so much entertainment and enjoyment throughout the years. But yeah, please keep doing what you're doing. And Alex, Ray, love you guys. And keep it up, man.
Thanks, Griffin.
All right, thank you.
That was very nice.
Congratulations on your engagement to pizza.
Yes, pizza engagement's very important. Yeah. I'm currently in a long-term relationship with pizza.
Yeah.
You're an engineer as well. You've already succeeded both of us. In
yeah, true.
Your career success.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Look, see, this is proof that even if you listen to this show from the beginning, you can still succeed.
Yeah. I am always curious, though, when someone says, I've been listening to you forever since episode one, it's like, is that where you first heard of us? Or, like, what was your entry point exactly?
The vibe I get from Griffin is listener since 2012. Is that when we started?
No, yes. I'm saying, how did you get to No More Whoppers? What was your entry point to No More Whoppers?
See, I always just say, and we talk about this in the bonus show.
Like
we talk about this in the bonus
show. Et cetera. Yeah.
Yes, we talk about this in the bonus show where I kind of credit the GIA for all of my, you know, as the basis for all of my success outside of the voice acting stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Because through the GIA, we got gamers.com. Through gamers.com, we got 1UP. Through 1UP, we got Retronauts. And through Retronauts, I think we got most of our listeners.
Yeah.
Or maybe, did we have the show? Yeah. Did we mention it during we were on that episode of Four Guys, 1UP? Did I say anything about it?
Sure.
Or in this thread or whatever the fuck it was called.
We did a promo for it, so yeah.
That's right, we did a promo. I remember we did one episode with Jose and Bob.
Yeah.
That was the one time I visited the 1UP mother base.
That's right.
Yeah, that was fun. It was good. It was a nice boys.
Don't say the other thing that happened, but yeah.
What's the other thing that happened?
Don't.
Are you talking about when we had shit stolen? Sorry. Look. It's a funny story now that I tell people. It's just stuff.
Okay, thank you.
I'm also, I mean, look, obviously I don't want to have my apartment robbed, but I'm at a place now where shit is just stuff.
Folks, Colin, what would you steal from Alex's apartment?
No! I mean, if I had to choose something to be stolen, I guess all these bills.
A donor pizza sounds good.
If you steal bills, you do have to pay them.
Okay.
Yeah, wait, what is it? What is a donor pizza?
I think that's what he said and meant, like a donor kebab.
Yeah. I've heard that before, but I don't know what it is.
Well, a donor kebab is a kebab. It's
okay.
Got Turkish ingredients on it and whatnot. A donor pizza, I think, is just that stuff on a pizza. I'm trying to think of the other thing, because in Canada they sell a lot of donaires. And so a donair is kind of the same thing, I believe. But it's always like a lot of like donair and pizza places in one. So it's like they're selling donairs and pizza. So,
is it because they just share a lot of ingredients?
Sure. Yeah. I mean,
I don't
whatever
know
works. Okay. Right. But, I know there's a lot of those in Canada, but Griffin's from South Carolina. I don't know. Maybe he moved to Canada when he became an engineer. No.
As should we all. When we become engineers.
No, I'm pretty sure he was doing the delivery driving in South Carolina, I'm going to presume. And I just didn't think that would have been a thing in South Carolina.
All right.
But it made me think, oh, is he from Canada? But then, oh, yeah, I guess not. Cool. Thanks for calling.
Okay. Yes, thank you very much.
Thank you for the kind words.
Yes, thank you for...
And next we have a caller from a serial killer.
Yes, Ray was very scared about this call, and rightly so. I feel like it's missing some key information, but I will play it now.
Have you tried putting the glasses over your mouth and the mask over your eyes?
Okay, a couple things. One, please, like our friends Franco and Griffin, please call in with your name. and any kind of confirmation that you are a human being. And maybe also include what you're talking about. Through context, I piece together, okay, somebody is helping me deal with the problem I have with my glasses fogging up when I wear a mask. Third of all, this is not the caller's fault, but the Google transcript just reads, I'm putting the glasses over your mouth and the mask over your eyes. And so that left us with it set a very frightening scene before we had even listened to this.
Yes.
But at the end of the day, success, because it is a great, it is a funny mental image, and I do appreciate it.
Yes.
And so, yes, I have tried. I've put my glasses in my mouth and the mask over my eyes. Makes food taste terrible and I can't even see it.
Yes, I believe they are poking fun at people who would say, you said people say to you, last time you were like, I'm going to cut everyone off right now. Yes, I've tried this with the mask. Yeah, so. I think he's making fun of that. So
fine. That's great.
Yeah.
Thank you, mystery caller.
Thank you, anonymous. More detail next time, please.
Yes.
Would love it.
Thank you, the Zodiac.
I would love it.
You okay?
Just doing my Costanza.
Okay. I like your Costanza.
It's extreme Costanza.
Can't stand you.
It's Italian.
Oh, God. Speaking of Italian, I do have a pizza in the freezer. Oh, my God. We can grill stuff again. I got...
All right.
Thanks to my buddy Tom. I call him my Tom. He gave me a very fancy microwave that was actually from his friend Emily when she moved. And then Tom just moved in with his girlfriend. I guess she already had a fancy microwave, so he gave me his fancy microwave. However, somewhere in the move, the tray that you need to use the fancy microwave as a grill was lost, and so we could only use it. It's a multifunction thing. We could only use it as a microwave. And then just this week, I finally went on the Sharp website and was like, oh, they sell replacement parts, replacement trays. So I just bought a tray, and it came yesterday, and like now we can grill again. It's very exciting. I have a pizza I've been saving in the freezer. I'm going to grill the fuck out of it.
Oh.
I'm going to eat it ravenously.
Please watch your language.
I'm going to eat the poop out of it. Sounds worse.
Yeah.
I'm just going to enjoy it.
Yeah, we had a pizza the day my wife came back. My mom, of all people, had a craving for a pizza. So she treated us to, first of all, her own pizza, personal pan pizza. Not a pan pizza, but a personal pizza. And, so Alex, you've had your pizza loop where you've gotten coupons after buying a pizza and then obligated to buy a pizza again. I had a pizza flub. I'm actually...
Wait, what?
Scared to even admit this in public, what I did.
Oh, my God.
I ordered a pizza to the wrong town.
Oh, no.
So I went through Round Table Pizza, number one in my heart. I went to their website, which is not a great website, but when you log in, they have the address of the closest store or the one that you picked on your profile. I read it too fast, thought it was still in San Jose. It was actually the store from the last town we lived in from 2 years ago.
Dear.
So I just went ahead and ordered. Time comes to go pick it up. I go to our nearby Round Table Pizza in San Jose to pick up the pizza. They say they don't have the order. I have now figured that because I don't like their website to begin with, I figured the order just got lost because they also have weird sort of they have a weird payment form where you have to enter things exactly and they don't like it a certain way. And so I just thought the order was eaten. I give them a couple minutes to confirm that they don't have it. I just leave exasperatedly. I say under my breath as soon as I reach the door frame, fix your fucking website, and then leave and go home.
Wow.
First, though, I do check my phone, log back into the Round Table Pizza website with my credentials and find out, oh, yeah, it had been choosing the one from the old city. I go back home. I am, I'm glad they didn't eat the order because then I, get a call from that restaurant saying, hey, we got your pizza for you. Would you like to come pick it up? And I said, no, actually, I was just about to call you and say that I need a refund because I don't live there anymore.
Oh.
Actually, the exchange was more like, I was actually going to call you because I made a mistake in ordering. I need to get a refund. And it's like, well, the pizza's ready. And I said, well, yeah, but I don't live there anymore. He goes, oh, okay, yeah, well, we can go ahead and do that for you. Okay, great. Okay, bye. And then a replacement pizza is ordered, and then we have fun. But, yeah, that was my pizza flub.
Wow.
So, actually, here was the error. So to change your home, you know, your favorite restaurant, you have to go into your account profile and manually select it from your profile to then permanently bond it to your account the next time you log in. It's not like every other restaurant's website that you log into where you can just select your closest restaurant from a map and set it as a favorite. No, you must actually go the long way around and then make a mistake later. And that's what happened.
Cool.
But the pizza was good.
Awesome. Now, hang on a second. I have I understand. You know me. I famously succumb to my own rage. yes. You know the kid making minimum wage at the register does not control the website.
Okay. I am fully aware of that.
Okay.
I'm very also very confident no one heard me because it is a long entryway into the restaurant. Okay. Okay. So I have done similar things before, and it is always on the way out so that no one actually hears me and catches me saying it and follows
it's just for
up.
You. It's a little nugget for you.
It kind of is just for me. Yeah. It kind of is. Yeah. But it's very infrequent. I don't have a lot of problems like that. And of course, I do understand it's not anybody's fault on the, you know, behind the counter.
Yeah.
Of course.
I do yell at people a lot on my Twitch stream. usually for humor. Sometimes not. And somebody came in the stream last time. I was playing Sea of Stars, and they're trying to sell me fucking, what is it? They were trying to sell me sub badges. They're like, I draw and sell sub badges. I notice you don't have any sub badges. Would you like to buy some sub badges? And I think if I were in a bad mood, I probably would have yelled at them and blocked them. And instead, I just said, no, thank you. And they said, okay, bye. Yeah. And that's all it has to be. I still respect this person's hustle. Ever since I got back into freelancing, doing voice stuff, and I realized how fucking annoying the hustle is, but you have to do it. Like, it's fine, whatever. They're not just spamming links or anything.
Reminds me of my last job where we were in a office complex, but like an old school type of thing where the door was unlocked and anybody could come in and solicit us. And it was always very awkward because it was such a small, tiny office. And it's just like, well, this person is trying to sell makeup for Valentine's Day. Yes, I have a wife. No, I'm not interested. Thank you. Please leave. Please do not walk more than, let's say, 1 foot into the door. Please. Wow. I don't really want to talk to you or interact with you or have this experience in my life. Goodbye.
Fun.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I suppose that's the show.
I think that is. Oh, wait. I also want to say big thanks to the Malik brothers, Nick and Alex, who visited the bar again. I hadn't seen them in years. I want to say, what, 5, 6 years?
How do you spell
that? Let's average it out. 5 years. M-A-L-I-K.
All right. So not I have their socials. M-A-L-L-O-C, which would be memory allocation.
No. I have their social security numbers upon request.
All right.
Yeah, they're very nice.
805 NMW Talk is the social security number to call.
That's right. The social security number to call. You dial the number and somebody answers the phone and just holds it up to a pile of money.
This will be yours one day.
I watched Alex beat The Legend of Zelda in one sitting on the first night, and then the next night he beat Second Quest in one sitting as well. That was a lot of fun. I'd never seen anyone beat Second Quest before.
All right, yeah.
And then Nick is his brother, who is, I think, about to start a master's program.
All right.
We'll be moving to Japan. They're both cool dudes. They can come to the bar anytime.
Master's in Japan.
That's right.
Not bad.
I think. Oh, yeah, because he's studying Japanese literature.
Okay.
You know, that kind of stuff.
Getting an MJL.
Yeah. What's that?
Master's in Japanese literature.
Oh, not... yeah, okay.
Yeah, I wouldn't.
I was gonna say Mark Jacob Lloridman after the wrestler MJF or Mark Jacob Friedman. That was look.
Oh, okay. Now
it's 3 p.m. I've got pizza on the brain. I gotta go.
Plans have been made in Alex's head.
Pizza plans have been made, and goddamn it. You know as well as I do, when you make pizza plans and they get broken, you get angry.
All right, let's break down this circus tent. Let's get out of
here.
All right,
break it down. Strike the set!
It's been No More Whoppers. The website's nomorewhoppers.com, but please also go to our Patreon, patreon.com/nomorewhoppers. You can give us $1 just to be cool, a gold subscriber, or you can give us $5 a month to be a golder subscriber and not only get this show a week early and without any kind of ad, but also access to our bonus shows, Golden 16 Seconds. Try that again, Ray. Maybe say the right word this time. Golden 16 Seconds and our new one, A Game Site About Nothing, the Crunk Games podcast, which will be a very personal history of us running an old video game website. And our Discord is also available. Link is long, but you'll find it on the .com. Everybody can come in and say hi. It's not a Patreon thing. Our merch is at shop.spreadshirt.com/numberwhoppers. You can find some shirts that we still have not updated. And I wouldn't blame you for not wanting to buy anything. But we also have some buttons and stickers and, you know, cool NMW logo things.
We got to get new shirts.
Yes, this is now year 10 of saying we got to get new shirts.
Yeah, but I mean it this time.
I really mean it.
Also, first of all, thank you, patrons. You help make the magic happen. Second of all, don't forget, I mentioned this during the second episode of the new bonus show, but don't forget, there is a special RSS feed for the bonus podcasts. You do not have to listen to the bonus podcasts in your browser like some sort of caveman. You can just copy the RSS feed into your podcast app of choice. Listen on the go.
You're not a caveman, are you? No, of course not.
You're not a caveman mechanic. I can't fix a caveman. What is that, 93 caveman?
Once again, the phone number is 805-NMW-TALK. Send us, what is it now, 60-second calls about...
Yes, yeah, new cap. This is we are now instituting what we call the Franco rule, which keep it to 60 seconds or less. Please have some sort of direction when you're calling. Please have something to say, like our pals, Griffin and Anonymous Glasses Murderer. Please have a point in calling. Thank you, Franco, for rambling about skateboards, etc.
Yeah, just make it.
He knows I'm fucking around. I love Franco. He's visited the bar. That means he's getting into heaven.
I would certainly hope so. He doesn't need to know that I'm not fucking around, but that's fine. You and I, Alex, are on the internet elsewhere. Would you like to talk about your presence?
Yes. Please visit patui.org to find everything I do in the world. It links to my voice work. You can find information about the bar, about this very podcast, my YouTube stuff, etc. You can also follow me at Blue Sky, also patui.org. I finally got that fixed up and ready. That's me.
Yeah.
You.
My main link site is rdbaaa.space. Still, just go there to catch up. I swear I'll update it. It's fine. In fact, I also just recently got on Blue Sky, and all by myself, I won an invite and just went on there because I was, you know, I have this weird mental hang up. I didn't like asking for invites. I think the whole invite thing is a little bit stupid, but hey, if I can get one without the rigmarole of having to ask anybody, then I'm cool. And so I'm now on there. I believe also as rdbaaa.space, but that's
noise.
They have a weird URL structure, and you know, you'll find me. Don't worry, it's always rdbaaa. Also, made a game called Blast Rush and Mash Gadget on Playdate, and in fact, I found out after finally getting my own Playdate that Mash Gadget doesn't exactly run correctly on the hardware, and it is not the fault of me; it is the hardware's fault. And I've been reaching out to see if maybe we can make some adjustments to maybe make Mash Gadget work a little better. The thing is, when you really, really mash it, like Takashi Meijin would, like a real shooting watch toy, it doesn't register the rapid... It basically conks out if you go too fast. And we can't have that.
No.
But Mash Gadget is nonetheless available if you have a Playdate.
Hey, pick it up now, because before that gets patched, that Playdate is going to be a collector's item. Like how people are selling PS4s with a PT demo on it for hundreds of dollars. Get yourself an extra Mash Gadget. Everybody buy... Yeah, what's it called? Hang on. The Playdate. Get yourself an extra Playdate. Load it up with Mash Gadget. Everybody buy it. Buy two so you can have a fixed one later.
Right.
And then sell the other one. Boom, put your kid through college.
I mean, that... Yeah, probably won't be necessary. I mean,
it's a collector's item, Ray.
I keep all my public versions. I think, you know, it'll be preserved.
Oh.
I'll give it to the right people when the time comes.
Okay. Well, then I've got an extra Playdate to
sell. You don't need to. Okay. Hey, wait a minute.
What? No, because I bought two.
All right. Doesn't your wife like video games?
No.
No.
No, she likes Panel de Pon and Mother 2, and I think those are the only two games.
Oh, right. Over here, it's Chrono Trigger and Earthbound. In Japan, it's Panel de Pon and Earthbound.
That's right.
The only two Super NES games. All right. Alex, thanks so much for being a good sport on this episode.
Kamae Tachi no Yoru.
All right. That too. That's a big one. Everybody else, keep your nose clean, and we'll see you next time. Gold subscribers, stick around till after the show. We're going down to the hippo track. Put down some cash.
Hang on. Back it up for a sec. Can I still play Fire Engine? Fire Engine?